It's Yankee warm-up time with Marv Albert.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Yankee Baseball Warm-Up. The warm-up brought to you by Knapp Shoes, who's opening a brand-new store near Menlo Park Shopping Center, Edison, New Jersey. And we suggest that you stop in June 1st, 2nd, and 3rd for their big grand opening. And this afternoon, I'm talking to you from the broadcast booth at Yankee Stadium, where in about 15 minutes, Joe Garagiola, Phil Rizzuto, and Jerry Coleman will be bringing you all the play-by-play right here on WHN. Today, a big holiday doubleheader. The Yankees and the Minnesota Twins, and for the Yanks, the start of a 16-game homestand. It's the Twins followed by the A's, the Tigers, the Senators, and the White Sox. And the hope is that the return here to home grounds will give the Yanks a needed lift. The scheduled pitchers this afternoon. In the first game, it should be Dave Boswell and Al Downing. And in the second game, Jim Merritt for the Twins, Fritz Peterson for the Yankees. Two big baseball stories today amidst all the baseball being played throughout the country. First off, the Whitey Ford situation. And about a half hour ago, it was officially announced Whitey has retired as an active player with the New York Yankees, and we'll get to that in just a moment. The other big story, the Mike Epstein trade, a trade pulled off last night by the Orioles as they sent Epstein along with young pitcher Frank Britannia to the Washington Senators for left-handed pitcher Pete Rickard. Baltimore general manager Harry Dalton said his first choice was Mel Stottlemyre, but the Yanks did not want to part with Mel, so he made the deal with Washington. And we'll talk about the reasons behind the Yanks not dealing for Epstein and a look at the Whitey Ford situation through the eyes of Yankee general manager Lee MacPhail. Now, Lee has become kind of a regular here on the warm-up, but we thought it apropos for Lee to give his reasons for not trading Stottlemyre, and we'll be talking in just a moment. Lee, first of all, the Whitey Ford situation.
Well, it's sad to all of us, Marv, but after waiting a period of time, Whitey's arm didn't feel any better than it had when he walked off the field in Detroit last week, and he came to the decision that he had no other course to follow but to retire. It makes all of us very sad. Whitey will stay with the organization just as long as he wants to. This year, he's going to do some scouting for us. He will scout the National League clubs, perhaps some spot scouting in the American League. We hope that he will have an opportunity to see all of our minor league pitchers, our better prospects, so he can help us in an evaluation of these, and possibly he will be working on the field with some of them and helping Floyd Boyer, our minor league pitching coach.
Leo, was said before today that Whitey would try the arm or test it out before the doubleheader. Did he do this at all, or did he just call it quits?
No, he did not. He knew without throwing that it wasn't any better, and that after talking again to Dr. Gaynor, he just decided that there was no use trying to push it any further. I don't think he wants to do anything that would hurt the club on the field, and he feels that perhaps in a way he was handicapping the club by going out and trying it in American League competition.
Lee, what are your first memories of Whitey Ford?
Well, actually, Whitey signed the year I came with the Yankees. That was 1946. I'd just gotten out of the service and was out in Kansas City running the AAA ball club out in Kansas City at the time that Paul Critchell signed Whitey Ford here in New York. Thinking of Whitey and thinking back to those days brings memories of Paul Critchell, who was a great Yankee scout. Of course, he has since left us. But one of my first memories of Whitey was when he went to Mexico with Clint Courtney in the winter, and the club didn't want him to go. And Critch used to call him regularly and threaten him with all sorts of trouble if he didn't come home. And Whitey actually did get dysentery down there, and it affected him a little bit the next year. The next memory I had of him is when we wanted to move him. He'd had a good year at Norfolk, and we wanted him to pitch the next year at Binghamton, and Whitey wanted to make that jump to AAA.
Whitey had a mind of his own.
Yes, he was a real fine minor league pitcher, and of course a great one when he came up here. And one of my first memories is everybody's, I guess, is Whitey's joining the club and winning about 9 straight ball games, and then the World Series game that he pitched against the Phillies when he almost had a shutout. A ball got away from Gene Woodling, a tough chance in deep left field, and Whitey had to be relieved, but won his first major league start.
And now there is an opening on the pitching staff, and there has been speculation that rookie Cecil Perkins will be brought up from Syracuse. When will a decision be made on this?
Well, a decision has been made, Marvin. Joe Verbanek is being brought up.
That's what I get for throwing names. I was going to say, how about Stan Bonson next?
Verbanek has been pitching very well up there. He doesn't have a great win and loss record because he's been starting, but he's pitched six or seven good innings each time out. And, of course, we have relief in mind for him. He is and always has been a relief pitcher and was just starting in Syracuse so he could get some extra innings under his belt.
And he had a pretty good spring.
Yes, he did. Very good.
Now, Lee, I'd like to get your version of the Mike Epstein situation. As we mentioned before, and as General Manager Harry Dalton said last night, the Orioles definitely wanted Mel Stottlemyre. The Yankees said no.
Right. Well, Marv, just to go back from the beginning, of course, we knew Mike. I knew Mike. We know he has real fine ability. He's a boy we'd like to have on our ball club for the future. And very early, you could foresee the problem that Baltimore was going to have with Boog Powell there, because I was convinced that Mike couldn't play the outfield, was going to have to play first base. So we told the Orioles we were interested. This winter, we told them we thought we would have surplus pitching and could talk to them along that line. And they promised us that they would talk to us before they closed any deal for Mike. Since that time, there have been several developments on our ball club. One, we don't have the surplus pitching that we thought we would have. Whitey, after looking very good in spring training at the start of the year, has had to retire. Jim Bouton is having trouble. Stan Bonson, whom we thought was going to be ready, we had to send back to Syracuse to get his feet on the ground. We have a few other problems. Fred Talbot's had a little trouble with his elbow. So we were hardly in a position to trade a pitcher, and certainly not to trade our number one pitcher, Mel Stottlemyre, who's basically the same age as Epstein. The other development was that Mickey came along so well at first base that we would have been giving up pitching, which is an extremely important commodity in which we don't have a surplus in now, for a player that could not play in our regular lineup at this time. We feel that, and Mickey feels, that perhaps he'll be able to play for another two or three years. Perhaps he'll be hurt today or tomorrow. God knows we all hope that he won't. But we can't go along with that assumption. We have to hope that, based on what Mickey has shown us, that he'll be playing first base for us for more years than just 1967.
Lee, on the other side of the ledger, and I think that baseball people will point to this, the fact that Epstein was traded to the Washington Senators along with a pitcher, a young pitcher, in Frank Britannia, and what they got was a left-handed pitcher by the name of Pete Rickett, who really has not been that impressive this season. Actually, Rickett is always a pitcher who's had a high earned run average. This year he's about 4.70, and he has a record of 2 up and 6 down, so this could be a little telling point. In other words, they had to give up something else aside from Mike Epstein to get a pitcher that has the record that Rickard does.
Yes, but I would have to say, Marv, that Rickard is a pretty good major league pitcher. It's true that he's had some trouble. He's had arm trouble in the past, but when he's all right, and apparently he is now, he did get off to a slow start this spring, but he's won his last couple of starts, and he could be a fine pitcher for the Orioles. I think it was a good trade for Baltimore, and Washington, of course, can use Epstein if he hits the way he hit in the minor leagues.
What is the baseball man's opinion of Epstein? Will he make it big?
Well, I think most people feel about Mike the way they feel about any other good young prospect. He has the tools. He has an opportunity to make it big. No one really knows until he puts it all together in the major leagues. Certainly, he's the kind of young player that you like in your organization and you would like to give a shot with on your ball club. Unfortunately, he's a first baseman, and that's one spot we're not in a position right now to give a young player a shot.
Lee, thank you very much once again.
Right, nice to be with you.
Lee MacPhail, the general manager of the New York Yankees, and we'll check out the rest of the baseball story in just a moment. Now to the rest of the baseball story in the American League. Aside from the Yankees and Twins here at the stadium, four other doubleheaders. The big one, the White Sox, playing two at Detroit, going in the first place Sox a half game in front of the Tigers. The scheduled pitchers for Chicago, Gary Peters and Tommy John, and for Detroit, Earl Wilson and Joe Spama. The Indians will play two at Baltimore, Sam McDowell and Luis Tiant going against Dave McNally and Wally Bunker. Bunker, a last-minute replacement for the now departed Frank Petania, who was scheduled to go, but Frank now wearing a Washington Senator uniform. At Boston, the Angels and Red Sox playing a pair should be George Brunette and Jack Sanford for the Angels, Dennis Bennett and Jose Santiago for the Red Sox. And a doubleheader at Washington between the A's and the Senators should be Jim Nash and Jim Catfish Hunter for KC, Phil Ortega and Barry Moore for the Senators. Over in the National League, two doubleheaders, three single games. The Mets in action tonight at L.A., single game against the Dodgers. Don Cardwell going against Don Sutton. Mr. Sutton off to a horrible start. He's won one and he's lost six. Sutton and Cardwell tonight out on the coast. Today, the big day at Indianapolis. The Indianapolis 500 getting underway. The weather report says clearing and the rain may hold back. The usual 300,000 plus on hand. And the favorites include Parnelli Jones, little Mario Andretti, and Dan Gurney. Today, a busy day in racing with two big ones at Aqueduct, the $112,000 Metropolitan Handicap, with the great Buck Passer back in action, apparently recovered from that hoof injury. And Buck Passer will be vying for the winner's share of $72,000. And at Garden State, Dr. Fager is the early line choice in the $100,000 added Jersey Derby. Getting back to baseball, while we have a moment here, a reminder about our letters to Ralph Houck and Lee MacPhail feature here on the warm-up. A chance for you to win two tickets to a Yankee game at the stadium. So if you have a question for Ralph or for Lee for a future warm-up, put that question on a postcard and mail it to me, Marv Albert, WHN, New York, 122. And if your question is used and WHN Sports selects the best questions, if that question is used, it means two free Yankee tickets. So get those questions in. Here at the stadium, Al Downing warming up for the Yankees, Dave Boswell getting ready for the Minnesota Twins. In just a moment, all the play-by-play coming up with Joe Garagiola, Phil Rizzuto, and Jerry Coleman. And that's about it for this session of the warm-up, brought to you by Knapp Shoes, who's opening a brand new store near Menlo Park Shopping Center, Edison, New Jersey. Stop in June 1st, 2nd, and 3rd for the grand opening. Following the doubleheader, I'll be back with a complete wrap-up of scores and late sports news on the scoreboard. Right now, stand by for a big day of baseball, the Yanks and the Twins in the first of the doubleheader. This is Marv Albert from Yankee Stadium for WHN Sports. It's Yankee baseball time.
On WHN. Yankees, they're gonna learn to fear the Yankees. Everyone knows they play to win, cause they're the New York Yankees. Show them today why you're the Yankees. No other way when you're the Yankees. What do you say? We win a brand new ball game. We're gonna shout when you powder the ball. We're gonna scream,
put it over the wall!
The other team's gonna know what it means to play the Y-A-N-K-E-E-S. We love the Yankees. Shout it out loud. We love the Yankees. We're really proud of our Yankees. And we wanna win today. 2, 3, 4, hit, run, high, score, go, go!
Welcome to New York Yankee baseball. Today, the Yankees meet the Minnesota Twins in a Memorial Day doubleheader. This first game broadcast is brought to you direct from Yankee Stadium by the G. Kruger Brewing Company of Cranston, Rhode Island. Brewers of light golden Kruger Pilsner, made a little at a time by people who take their time. Kruger Pilsner, the world's most perfect beer. And by your participating Flying A dealer, where you can win up to $2,500 playing Flying Aces. Hi, everybody. This is Phil Rizzuto welcoming you to New York Yankee baseball. Jerry Coleman, Joe Garagiola, and I are on hand to bring you all the action. And speaking of Jerry, here he is with the starting lineups in the pregame color. Jerry Coleman.
Okay, Phil, I think because of the pace of the activity this morning, Whitey Ford announcing his retirement, that we'll hold off on the starting lineups. And before we go into any conversation concerning Whitey Ford, I think it might not hurt to move into a commercial, and then it'll leave the air open for us where we can talk about Whitey and the activity involved. So right now, let's hear this word. Well, today was a day that very few ball clubs like to see, a day when the Yankees lost probably their greatest pitcher of all time, Whitey Ford, to retirement. Whitey Ford, in his great career with the Yankees, and you look at it, when he quit, he was tops in the major leagues in wins, 236, in shutouts, 45, in strikeouts, 1,956. Incidentally, these figures are all Yankee highs. His lifetime earned run average for 498 ball games was a remarkable 2.74. And his lifetime winning percentage, 236 wins, 106 losses. And this was a mark of 690, which is the highest ever achieved by a pitcher with 200 or more victories since 1900. I had the opportunity, as well as my colleague, Phil Rizzuto here, to play with Whitey Ford for a number of years. And Phil, I guess if you want to pick one thing about Whitey, the thing that strikes me most was the tremendous intestinal fortitude, the tremendous drive and pride of a Whitey Ford and what he meant to the Yankees over 18 years.
You're absolutely right, Jerry. And as you and I both know, he was great to play in backup, always around the plate. And every time he went out there, as we both know, and I'm sure most of the fans realize by now, he went out to win. There was no fooling around with Whitey, even though he's one of the funniest, naturally funniest fellas that you'd ever want to see. A fella that could pick up the club with a joke here and a wisecrack there. But yet when he went out on that mound, I mean, he was all business. And just a great competitor. And it's got to be one of the saddest days in Yankee history, Jerry.
Well, Phil, they had a press conference that we attended before the ballgame in the press room announcing Whitey's retirement. The umpires and the managers were on the field right now, but there's quite a phalanx of photographers and newsmen down on the field, and they're going to announce publicly to the fans here on this beautiful Memorial Day here in New York, the Twins and the Yankees going at it in a doubleheader. They're going to announce publicly that Whitey Ford has retired from the scene. And one of the nice things about Whitey's retirement, if you can say there is a nice thing, that he'll remain with the Yankees in a capacity as a scout and being used in spot assignments, possibly scouting the National League and visiting some of the minor league clubs. And Phil, if I was a young left-hander, brother, what you could learn from a Whitey Ford?
Well, there's nothing that you couldn't learn. He knows everything in the books. They're going to announce this in just about 1 minute, but maybe we've got time on New York Yankee Baseball to pause briefly for station identification.
There are more prizes for you to win in Jack Sterling's jackpot. Your name could be announced Monday morning at 7:15 here on WHN 1050 New York.
Well, Jerry, it looks like it was timed perfectly. They're waiting for Whitey Ford to come up the steps now, and as you said, the photographers and the television cameras and the radio men are all poised, waiting for Whitey to come out now. And this is, you know, for a few moments in there, I thought Whitey was going to burst into tears. He had to do a job holding them back.
Bill, it was the first time that I ever saw Whitey Ford or Ralph Houck, and these are two tough competitors, with near tears in their eyes. In fact, Whitey's eyes were filled. They didn't spill over, but it was close.
Boy, it certainly was.
And Ralph Houck had to put his head down and back out of the room in a hurry after he made his very brief talk.
I don't know about you, but all of a sudden I'm getting goosebumps. It's just hard to believe that Whitey Ford is no longer going to be out there, the chairman of the board, as Elson Howard calls him, on the mound pitching for the Yankees anymore.
Remember that first year, 1950, when he came up in midseason from Kansas City, and all he did was win nine and lose one and hand us the flag?
He certainly did, and won a big ball game in the World Series. And he was just as cocky then as he is now, and that's one of the great things about Whitey. He didn't care who he was pitching against or who the Yankees were playing. He knew what he could do, and he went out there and did the job.
Phil, I think one of the things I remember most about Whitey Ford and his career was the day that Luke Easter bowled him over at first base. I happened to throw the ball, and Ford to this day accuses me of trying to eliminate him in his early stages. And that big loose Easter, 6 feet 5 inches tall, and knocked him down. The ball went flying. And what did Whitey do? He picked up the ball and threw out Rosen going into third. Oh, boy, I tell you, that takes a lot. Normal ball player would still be laying on the ground. And even a veteran who had a lot of experience might have been stunned and just picked the ball up, and the runners would have all advanced. But that's one thing about Whitey. Of course, one of the reasons why he won a lot of games, Jerry, we knew he fielded his position as well or better than any other pitcher in the big league.
He was probably the best young pitcher that I ever saw. He came up at 21, and he was a polished performer then. And he was a type of a guy. In the 1957 series, Phil, I played a ball badly off the bat of Eddie Matthews. He beat out the ball and ended up as being the only run of the game. Ford was pitching, and we lost 1-0. And after the game, all of the reporters were crowding around my cubicle, not because I'd been the hero, but because I was the GOAT, and asking me questions. And Whitey, who was right next to me, he said, "Leave him alone." He said, "Leave him alone." You know, I could have shut him out.
Oh, boy, that's great. I mean, and at that time, you really appreciated those words, I'm sure.
No question about it. We're still waiting here on a beautiful, sunny Sunday. I tell you, it's absolutely tremendous day. Few clouds off in the skies. Temperature bordering around the mid-70s. The umpires and the managers have concluded their activity at home plate, and we're right now waiting for the announcement from the PA announcer, Bob Shepard, relating to Whitey Ford. Let's
Whitey
go down on
Ford,
the field.
Greatest Yankee pitcher of all time, has just announced his retirement as an active player. Yankee, he will remain in the Yankee organization on special assignment. Will you join us now in paying a parting tribute to this magnificent Yankee?
Person, everybody in this great ballpark, and it's a huge crowd on hand today for the Memorial Day doubleheader, stood up and gave Whitey Ford a rousing ovation as he announces his retirement from baseball. Whitey Ford, gone from the scene but never forgotten. Take a look at the starting lineup very quickly for you. For the Minnesota Twins, Cesar Tovar in center field leading off, Rod Carew at second base, Zola Versalles at shortstop, Harmon Killebrew at first, Tony Oliva in right, Bob Allison in left, Rich Rollins at third, Jerry Zimmerman behind the plate, and Dave Boswell, a right-hander, will pitch, and he'll be batting ninth. For the Yankees, Park at second, Tresh in left, Mantle at first, Pepitone in center, Whitaker in right, Gibbs behind the plate, Smith at third, Amaro the shortstop, and Al Downing will pitch, and he'll be batting ninth. While we wait for this ball game to get underway, right now, Robert Merrill, Metropolitan Opera star, who tape-recorded national anthem, will now be sung.
Why?
Whitey Ford, who retired today from the active scene, now becomes a memory. A great Yankee of the past, no longer active on the scene. And the man sitting next to me, Phil Rizzuto, when he came along, the likes of the Joe DiMaggio's, the Bill Dickey's, the Joe Gordon's, the Kellers and the Hendricks, Sternweiss's, the Red Rolfs, Bill Dickey's, the Barras, Rashies, Reynolds and Lopats. He played with them all. And coming on now to bring you the play-by-play, a man who is a fabled Yankee himself, the Scooter, Phil Rizzuto.
Well, thank you, Jerry, and it's going to be kind of tough after that talking about Whitey Ford, the way you and I were doing, and then hearing the tremendous ovation he got from these fans, to not have that in the back of your mind all during the ballgame.
See, it seems to really transcend the ballgame in a sense, if that's possible, but nevertheless, it's nice to have Whitey around, even if it's not on the playing field. He's the kind of a guy that can keep things going.
He really is. But we do have a ball game, and right now, Billy Martin, the third base coach, is talking with plate umpire Frank Eumont. And Larry Knapp comes by. Now, don't forget the ball fans in the Binghamton area. Jack Reed and his Binghamton triplets meet York in Binghamton in a doubleheader tonight at 6:30 p.m. You fans certainly remember Jack Reed hit that home run, and that, matter of fact, was his only big league home run, I think, Jerry.
Well, it was the biggest one he ever hit, I'm sure of that, the 22nd inning.
Right, out in Detroit, and Jack is managing the Binghamton triplets, and they're meeting York in Binghamton in a doubleheader tonight at 6:30. Well, right now, one of the real pleasant surprises for manager Sam Mealy and the Twins, Cesar Tovar leading off. He's batting .304, has 11 doubles, 2 triples, 3 homers, 10 RBIs, and 5 stolen bases. Cesar Tovar from Caracas, Venezuela. 5 feet 9, 155 pounds. On the mound, Al Downing. Downing's 9th game and his 6th start. This is his first against the Twins this year. And the last time out, Downing pitched a complete game for the first time since June 3rd, 1966. It was a two-hitter. The low-hit game of any Yankee pitcher this year. And his first pitch is taken outside, ball one. I told you, Billy Martin coaching at third. Big Jim Lemon at first for the Twins. The pitch to Tovar. He bluffs a bunt, takes it for a strike. Al Downing had 13 strikeouts against the Baltimore Orioles, and that was the only game the Yankees won in that series. Downing has 1-4, lost 3. The pitch is low outside. 2 balls and 1 strike. And you couldn't have asked for a prettier day, Memorial Day. And we hope it's this nice everywhere that you people can hear and all over the country. On deck is Rod Carew. The pitch is just inside. Jake Gibbs and Downing both thought they had that pitch on the inside corner, but it's 3-1. Charlie Smith playing even with the bag at third. Mantle not too deep at first. The 3-1 delivery is strike two called. Tovar taking all the way. Last year for Minnesota, in 134 games, Tovar batted .260. He had only 2 home runs all year, and already he's got 3. Here's the payoff pitch to the leadoff batter. Swing and a miss, strike 3. It was foul tip, and Gibbs held on to it. And how do you like that Downing, Jerry? He threw him a breaking pitch, 3-2.
Phil, that was quite a pitch. Tovar almost ran into the ball looking for the fastball, and if you can throw the kind of a curveball that Downing has over the plate, 3-2, you're going to win a lot of ball games.
That's for sure. And it looks like Downing might have got his confidence back down in Baltimore.
Might mention, too, that Jim Turner's been working with Downing to cut down on the amount of the curve and make it faster and sharper.
Well, it sure looks like it's paying off. Right now, here is Rod Carew, another fella that's been a pleasant surprise, batting .319 with 6 doubles, 1 triple, 2 homers, and 16 RBIs. Takes a pitch inside, ball one. It's the first time that the Twins have been to the stadium this year. Carew is from the Panama Canal Zone. swings and hits one to short left field. That's going to be in, and extra bases. It kicks off the wall. A fan grabs it, and it's a ground rule double. And, man, he looked like he served that one out there, just dropped it inside the line. So Rod Carew dumps a double in a short left field. The first hit of the ball game. And for Carew, his seventh double of the year. The batter now is Zoilo Versailles. Zoilo batting 277. After a miserable start, he's really come along. He has five doubles, four triples, one homer, 21 RBIs. One out with a runner at second base. Peru leading off second. Looks like he can run too. The Twins with great speed. The pitch to Versailles is popped foul, but coming back into the crowd and out of play. Hit it right off the end of the bat. Ball bounced in the lower box seats and right on up to the press box. Versailles from Havana, Cuba. So the first three hitters in the Oriole lineup are from Latin American countries. And he's 5'10", 160 pounds. Most of those boys really have the speed. I don't know of any that can't run. Possible exception of Orlando Cepeda, who could run before he hurt his knee. One man out. Carew leads off second. The stretch by Downey. His pitch to Versailles. Pop foul again and out of play. That was a changeup that Versailles was out in front of. Got around on it. Two quick strikes on the right-hand hitting shortstop for the Twins. On deck, Harmon Killebrew. The bat boy now had a little huddle with the plate umpire. And some of the Twins sitting on the top step of the dugout have to get their feet now inside the dugout. Trying to take advantage of the sun. All right, the stretch by Downing. The pitch to Versailles, a ground ball foul, almost got Billy Martin in the coaching box. Count remains, nothing in two. Fan was trying, stretching by his shoe tops to get that foul ball, just couldn't reach it on the playing field. Yankees play Versailles just about straight away. Tresh in left, Pepitone in center, Whitaker in right. The pitch, swing and a miss, strike three. Again he foul tipped it, and again Gibbs held onto it, and that time it was a good fastball, and it looked like Versailles was looking for the breaking pitch. So Downing gets two strikeouts here in the first inning, and it brings up the killer, Harmon Killebrew, batting 267. He has six doubles, nine homers, and 30 RBIs. Killebrew now has 345 lifetime home runs with the nine he has this year. Powerful batter. 5'11", 210 pounds. The pitch to Killebrew, a curve over the outside corner, strike one call. And what a spot he put that pitch in. Downing goes to the rosin bag. On deck is Tony Oliva. No score here. We're in the top of the first inning. Still plenty of time for you fans driving around to get out here. Still some good seats available. Another game to go. The changeup, swing and a miss, strike two. Downing really mixing his pitches up beautifully here in the top of the first inning. He has had every hitter off stride, including Carew, who got the bloop double of left field. Carew hit the ball right off his fist, and there's no defense against that kind of a ball. Nothing in two on Killebrew. Downing stretches. The pitch, fastball, line to left foot foul. Downing trying to get the fastball by Killebrew after throwing him a good change of pace, but the killer was ready. He got out in front of it just a little too much. So Downing gets a new baseball. Steve Whitaker well over in right center field for Killebrew, who very seldom hits to right field. Rod Carew leading off second base. Downing sets, checks the runner, delivers. It's just outside. One ball, two strikes. Oh, Downing trying to get Killebrew to nibble at a pitch not in the strike zone. Downing looks in, gets the sign from Gibbs. A long look in. Now he's got it, and he took too long. Killebrew asked for time at the plate. Armin Killebrew had 39 home runs last year and 110 RBIs. He was runner-up to Frank Robinson in both those categories. The pitch is a ground ball, hit the third. Charlie Smith up with it. Fires to Mantle in time, and the side is out. For the Twins, no runs on one hit, no Yankee errors, and one man left at the end of one half inning. Minnesota nothing, and the Yankees coming to bat.
You know, Americans have a wonderful way of always finding something to celebrate. We've got holidays for important events like July the 4th and important people like Washington's birthday. There's Valentine's Day for lovers of love and Arbor Day for lovers of trees. And a very special kind of celebration for lovers of good food, good company, and good drink. So special that it's celebrated not for just one day, but for an entire month. The occasion? National Tavern Month, and it's going on right now for the entire month of May. You know, the tavern is one of the oldest institutions in the nation and one of the friendliest places in town, where you find that superb philosopher, the bartender, and where you get some of the best food and drink anywhere, like Light Golden Kruger Pilsner, the beer that's brewed a little at a time by people who take their time so that every glassful is as perfect as beer can be. Drop in soon to your favorite neighborhood tavern and say hello to the guy behind the bar. Join in the fun with a round or two of Kruger Pilsner. It's a perfect beer to celebrate National Tavern Month, or July the 4th, or any time at all.
On the mound for the Twins, young Dave Boswell, who has won one and lost two this year. Against the Yankees' lifetime, he has won three and lost none. Last time Boswell faced the Yankees, he was not involved in the decision, but he allowed three runs in two and a third innings. One of those runs a home run by Mickey Mantle. But the Twins eventually won that game 4-3. So Dave Boswell is out on the mound. He is from Baltimore, Maryland, 6'3", 185 pounds. Last year with the Twins, he won 12 and lost 5. The Twins have an unusual way to put in their notes. In other words, the pitchers that are pitching today, they list as today's twosomes, Dave Boswell and Jim Merritt. Then on Wednesdays, they've got Wednesday's wingers. And on Thursday, Thursday's throwers. So the statistician has a little bit of a sense of humor. Horace Clark leads off for the Yankees. Clark batting .225, has two doubles, one homer, and nine RBIs. Horace from St. Croix in the Virgin Islands. Switch hitter, batting left-handed. The slow curve is low and inside, ball one. Rich Rollins at third, trying to loosen up, doing some hops and steps down there. Looks like a new dance. He's in on the edge of the infield grass. The rest of the infield is pulled in at short, second, and first. Fastball fouled back on the screen, and the count is even at 1-1. There's no score in this ball game. Twins got off to a horrible start. Right now, they are one game under 500 and six games out of first place. They're in fifth place in the American League. The Yankees right now are in eighth place. There's a pitch high and outside. Two balls and a strike. But it's so close between third place Baltimore and last place Washington that just a little bit of a winning streak, and the standings could be reversed. Here's the 2-1 delivery, a curve that's on the inside corner, 2-2. Boswell has a very deceptive changeup curveball that he throws with the same motion that he uses for his fastball and fast curveball. On deck, Tommy Tresh. Boswell into the windup. He check swing fouls it and back into the crowd out of play. Boswell had taken something off the pitch, and Horace just could not check the swing, but he's got a life. Bob Allison playing very shallow in left field as he sees a Tovar in center. Again the pitch outside, and it's a full count, 3-2. Horace Clark, who has walked 13 times this year. He's also struck out 14 times, which is unusual for Horace. Usually gets a piece of that ball. Here's the payoff pitch. Ground ball hit to third. Bounces off the chest of Rollins to throw to first in time. And Rollins really hounded that ball. It bounded high off his chest, but fortunately kicked right in front of him. He ran about 6 feet, picked it up barehanded, and threw clock out. One away. And here is Tommy Tresh. Tom really battling a slump. He's been hurt both legs. He's fouled pitches down off his feet, ankles, insteps, shins. He's batting 197 with six doubles, one triple, four homers, and 14 RBIs. The slow curve is low, ball one to Tommy Tresh. Tommy has walked 18 times this year, but he struck out 34 times, by far the most of any Yankee. And his timing has really been off. Boswell's pitch is on the inside corner, one and one. Tommy from Detroit, Michigan, 6'1", 192 pounds. There's a foul back upstairs and out of play. One ball, two strikes. Well, in case you tuned in late, Whitey Ford announced his retirement today as an active player. Sad day for the Yankees, but the good news is that Yankees will retain Whitey Ford, and he'll be working with Ralph Houk. There's a ground ball hit to first base foul. Killebrew in back of the bag up with it. One ball, two strikes, one out. Nobody on, no score in the bottom of the first inning. And this is just the start of the first game of this doubleheader. Still plenty of time to get out here. See most of this first game and all of the second game. There'll be a lot of action at Yankee Stadium today. The pitch, swing and a miss, strike three. So Tommy Tresh strikes out, and here comes Mickey. Batting 246, three doubles, 11 homers, 21 RBIs. Mickey, 6 feet tall, 201 pounds. Batting left-handed, deep in the box, takes it high, ball one. Mantle is just two homers behind Frank Robinson, who leads the American League with 13. The pitch, changeup on the outside corner, one and one. Mantle with 507 lifetime homers, four behind Mellott's 511th, which will make Mickey number five on the all-time home run list. As a ground ball hit to second base, up with it, Peru over to first in time, and the Yankees are down in order here in the bottom of the first inning. Three up, three down, and the score at the end of one full inning. The Twins nothing and the Yankees nothing.
You know, every now and then I get a chance to talk to some of the real old-timers who can remember the early days of baseball. And a lot of them tell me baseball isn't what it used to be, and that beer isn't what it used to be. Now, it's mighty tough to change an old-timer's opinion about baseball, but I can sure change their minds awfully fast about beer. I just invite them to try a Kruger Pilsner. You see, Kruger Pilsner is brewed just a little bit at a time, the way beer used to be brewed years ago. Quality, not quantity. That's the Kruger people's philosophy. And let me tell you, it works. Yes, sir. That good old unhurried way is really the only way to brew a beer with lightness and flavor. Flavor that keeps you coming back for more. So look for Kruger Pilsner tonight. And let me tell you, you may have to do some looking, but it's worth it. The Kruger Pilsner people will never be able to say they brew the most, but they don't mind as long as they can say they brew the best.
Well, we get ready for the top of the second inning. No score in the ballgame. Tony Oliva will lead off. But a reminder, this Friday night is Union County night here at Yankee Stadium. And you Union County fans who do not have your tickets can purchase them here at Yankee Stadium Friday night at Booth 12. Remember, that's Booth 12, and you'll still be seated with the Union County group. Tony Oliva, who has been injured most of this year. Now, when you see Oliva batting average 204, you know that it's either got to be a typographical error or that he has been injured, because here is one of the most natural 300 hitters you'd ever want to see. He has 5 doubles, 1 triple, 1 homer, and 8 RBI. Oliver, a left-hand batter. He is from Cuba. 6 feet 2, 190 pounds. Stands deep in the box. Downing's pitch is high. No, it's not. It's on the inside corner. Strike one. Oliva doesn't believe it. He had fallen away as though trying to get out of the way and not get hit by the pitch. So I better stop watching the batter and watch the umpire. From the way Oliva reacted, it looked like the pitch was high and inside. But Frank Umont stuck up the right hand. The next pitch. Just inside, one and one, and Oliva turns and looks back at Frank Umont. He jumped away from that pitch. On deck is Big Bob Allison. Oliva, who led the American League in batting in 64 and 65 and just missed in 66. Low and inside, two balls and a strike. Downing gets the sign. Delivers. He throws his bat, and Downing just did jump out of the way. Holy cow. You know, you forget things, Jerry, you know, but Oliver is one of the guys that really lets go of that bat.
Well, we've got a couple of them now. We've got that Jose Vidal from the Indians who unloaded in the Yankee dugout in Cleveland and then into the stands over the dugout. And now Oliva, because of that big bump that he had on his middle finger of his right hand, consistently let the bat go for a couple of years, but he apparently overcame it. Now he's back again.
Well, he was certainly fooled on the pitch, and it's a good thing Downey jumped. Here is the 2-2 delivery. He threw the bat again and hit the ball a second. Clock up with it, throws to first in time. Mantle makes a great stretch. And Downing is a little shaken up out there on the mound, Jerry.
Phil, this is a strange thing. When a ball goes out towards you and the bat follows, believe me, you're not watching the ball much, because the bat's a thing that catches your eye. And I don't know whether Oliva's trying to intimidate Downing or not, but he's doing a pretty good job.
Boy, he certainly is. Right now, Big Bob Allison batting 237. Big right-hander. Downing's pitch is high, ball one. Allison has 7 doubles, 2 triples, 5 homers, 21 RBIs. The next pitch is a changeup, outside, ball two, 2-0. That ball just missed the outside corner. No score in the ball game in the top of the second. The 2-0 pitch, outside, ball three, 3-0. Downing trying to pitch away from Allison, has just missed the outside part of the plate. Billy Martin flashing some signs. Could almost call Martin a Martian. Get away with it. The 3-0 pitch is over, strike call, 3-1. Billy has been called some choice names in his day, Jerry.
By more than a few people.
That's for sure. Really a pepper pot. He didn't mind getting in trouble. The 3-1 delivery. In there, strike two called. 3-2. So now we come down to the all-important pitch. 3 balls, 2 strikes, 1 out, nobody on. On deck, Rich Rollins. Yankee outfield deep on Bob Allison, who really wears his pants high. Boy, he's like the miniskirt the girls wear. That's the way Allison wears his pants. Here's the payoff pitch. Strike three, swinging. Beautiful changeup. And before Rollins comes up on New York Yankee baseball, let's pause briefly for station identification.
Two tickets to a Yankee game and a bonus prize are yours if Jack Sterling reads your Yankee schedule lucky number. Monday morning at 7:30 here on WHN 1050 New York.
Rich Rollins. Batting 244, 3 doubles and 10 RBIs. 3 strikeouts for Downing in the ballgame. The pitch is popped up to the right side. Horace Clark calling for it. Between first and second. Is there, makes the catch. An easy inning for Downing as it's 3 up, 3 down. And the score at the end of an inning and a half, the Twins nothing and the Yankees nothing.
La Light Kruger Pilsner, Bright Kruger Pilsner. It's just a special beer for any time at all. We take our time to make it a fine brew. Made a little at a time, it's the world's most perfect beer. Light Kruger Pilsner, Bright Kruger Pilsner. And when you're thirsty, it's the taste that's crisp and clear. 'Cause it's perfect beer, it's Kruger Pilsner. Like festive flavor, that's Kruger Pilsner.
We take our time, and we brew it light. We think it's the world's most perfect beer. Product of G. Kruger Brewing Company, Cranston, Rhode Island.
Well, we get ready for the bottom of the second inning, and right now, one of the members of the ground crew going out to the mound, it seems like Boswell is complaining a little bit about where he finishes up on his follow-through, and they're raking it to smooth it out. The applause is for Joe Pepitone, who's just been announced. And while they're straightening out the pitcher's mound, it looks like they're not enjoying the beautiful weather in other parts of the country that we're having here, because the Indianapolis 500 has been postponed because of rain and will be held tomorrow. Well, that's a tough break for the racing buffs who have traveled thousands of miles out to Indianapolis to see that race. But it will be held tomorrow. They have the mound straightened out. Pepitone getting ready to step in the batter's box. Joe batting 258. Has four doubles, one triple, two homers, and 15 RBIs. And just to note that Joe Verbanek, who did so well for the Yankees in spring training, a young pitcher, has been recalled from Syracuse, the Yankees' AAA farm, and is due to join the club today. And Verbanek will fill the spot on the roster left void with the retirement of Whitey Ford, as we had announced earlier. And right now, Frank Crisetti is coaching at first base. We'll tell you about that in a minute. High ball one, and Lauren Babe at third. Jerry was there, and I wasn't, when that bat hit him in the knee, Jerry. You'll have to tell the folks about that.
That was the one that Jose Vidal swung at. The bat sailed into the dugout and hit Frank on the knee, and he's having trouble moving.
Pepitone pops one up. The catcher can't see it, and neither can Killebrew, and it drops him. What a break Pepitone got. Jerry Zimmerman broke the wrong way, broke to his left. Killebrew started back, and it should have been a routine foul pop-up. Pepitone thought he was out. He started to walk to the dugout, but the ball dropped harmlessly between the catcher and the first baseman. What a break for Joe.
Phil, going back to that Crisetti thing, people might wonder why a coach has to move, but the third base coach has to run down that line to hold men up late, and Frank just couldn't do it.
Right. The pitch to Pepitone. Foul back upstairs and out of play. One ball, two strikes. And also, the Yankee dugout is much closer to first base. So they not only switch Mantle to first to play to save his legs, but now they switch Crisetti from coaching at third to first to save his knee. And it's so unusual, you just automatically say Crisetti coaching at third, but there he is at first. Pepitone tries to check his swing, pops one foul, Zimmerman coming back, and he can't quite reach it. Had he gotten back there soon enough, he'd have been able to make a play. It went into the first row of box seats along the Twins dugout. So Zimmerman having a little trouble with the foul pops here early in the ball game. So let's see if Pepitone can turn two lucky breaks into a way to get on first base. These things very seldom happen in a ball game. Nobody out and nobody on. Boswell into the windup. His pitch, line drive, he did it, a base hit to right field. A high fastball that Pepitone really butcher boyed and sent a bullet out into right field. So that's the breaks of the game. Baseball just a matter of inches. And Pepitone just inches away from being retired on two foul pops. Takes advantage and singles to right. It's the first hit for the Yankees, and here is Steve Whitaker. Steve batting 262, five doubles, one home at 12 RBIs. No score in the bottom of the second. On deck, Jake Gibbs. Killebrew holds the bag against Pepitone. The pitch is high and outside, ball one. Pepitone leads away. Boswell stretches. Delivers. It's right down the middle. Strike called. 1-1. By the way, tomorrow, Thad Tillotson will get his first major league start. Pitching for the Yankees, Thad has been used only in relief all through spring training and up to this point of the season. 1-1 pitch. Hit deep to right field. That's gone way back there. Upstairs, home run. Second home run of the year, and that was really a powerhouse way upstairs, about one-third of the way in the upper deck. And the Yankees lead 2-0. And for Whitaker, he now has 14 runs batted in. Here is Jake Gibbs. Jake batting .216, two doubles, five RBIs. Pitch to Gibbs is inside, ball one, as he checked his swing in time. On deck, Charlie Smith. Boy, they are really overshifted on Gibbs in the outfield. Look at that center fielder. The pitch is inside. 2-0. Jerry, I don't remember seeing any other team overshift Gibbs like this.
Not really, because Jake has been pushing the ball straight away. In fact, he's been doing a lot of hitting to left field, but each club reads a ball player differently.
Right. If he hits one right over second base, he's got an extra base hit. There's ball three. 3-0. Cesar Tovar is way over in right center field. And Olivo over near the line. Allison moving a little more over towards center now. The 3-0 pitch right down the middle, 3-1. The infield is overshifted a little bit, but nothing like the outfield. Here's the 3-1 pitch. A ground ball to his right is Carew up with it. Throws to first base in time for the out. So that's the first out here in the bottom of the second. The Yankees lead 2-0. And here is Charlie Smith. Smith batting .243, has five doubles, one homer, and 10 RBIs. And they are taking down the tarpaulin in center field, and that'll be the first time this year that they are doing that. The pitch to Smith is low, ball one. Usually they let that up so that the hitter has a better background. But it looks like the bleachers might be filled before the day is over, Jerry.
It's great for the fans. A little rough on the ball players at the plate.
It sure is. The pitch, slow curve, high. Two balls, no strikes on Smith. On deck, Ruben Amaro. I tell you, way back when they used to play those Sunday doubleheaders and the bleachers would be filled, both managers would try to get any pitcher who could pitch directly overhand. Fastball, swing and a miss. Two balls and a strike. And when a pitcher throws directly overhand, the ball seems to be coming right out of the white shirts of the fans who sit in the bleachers, and it's really rough for the hitter to pick up that ball. The 2-1 pitch, a curve pull foul over towards the Twins dugout, 2-2.
Phil, I think the crowd today is a tremendous tribute to the work and ingenuity of the new Yankee management in reintroducing the fun of going to a ball game at Yankee Stadium here. It's been paying off.
It certainly has, Jerry. They enjoy the way the stadium has been painted, bright new colors. Sidearm fastball a little high. He had Smith fooled on that pitch. That's the first time he's come sidearm. Charlie could not uncock the bat, but fortunately it was a little high, and it's a full count, 3-2. Outfield plays Smith straight away. The pitch, a curveball, check swing, ground ball to first. Killebrew to his right, up with it. Flips to Boswell in time to get Charlie Smith. Charlie was trying to check his swing and accidentally hit the ball. Two away, and the batter is Ruben Amaro. And Ruben getting more and more notice now. He's batting .290 with two doubles, three RBIs. He's the leading hitter amongst the Yankee regulars. Two out, nobody on. Yankees lead 2-0, bottom of the second. Boswell delivers a curve, low and away, ball one. On deck, Al Downing. Tomorrow night, Kansas City will be here at 8 p.m., white shoes and all. Alvin Dark with a good young ball club. Fastball is on the outside corner, 1-1. And then the big weekend set with Detroit. The 1-1 curve is over. Beautiful changeup curveball. One ball, two strikes. Two out and nobody on. Boswell into the windup. Sidearm fastball, low and away, 2-2. Tovar shading Amaro over towards right center field. Rubin has been pulling the ball much more of late, really getting his wrists into his swing. Here's the 2-2 delivery, a curve, a ground ball to second base. Carew on the big hop, flips to Killebrew in time. But the Yankees come up with two runs on two hits. No twin errors, nobody left. At the end of two full innings, the Yankees 2 and the Twins nothing.
Well, the Scooter just mentioned this big weekend set that's coming up with the Detroit Tigers, and it's going to be a beauty. Be June the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th, Friday night, Saturday afternoon, and the doubleheader on Sunday. And that Saturday afternoon day is going to be a ladies' day, charm day for all you lovely ladies out there coming to the ballpark, and also senior citizens' day. A big game with the Detroit Tigers, who are currently neck and neck with the White Sox for the lead in the American League. And then the doubleheader on Sunday. And the following weekend, some more big baseball with the Chicago White Sox Friday night, Saturday afternoon, Ladies' Day, and the Sunday doubleheader, which will be bat day. All you youngsters 14 years of age and under, free Little League bat, whether it's a boy or a girl, when you're accompanied by an adult. That'll be June 9th, 10th, and 11th. So the next two weekends are going to be big ones here at Yankee Stadium for everybody, young and old alike.
The top of the third inning, and Jerry Zimmerman will lead off. Zimmerman catching. Earl Batty had x-rays taken on his finger yesterday. He had a dislocation of the ring finger of his right hand when he was hit by a foul tip off the bat of Joe Nosek. That was in the second inning of Sunday's second game in Kansas City. So Zimmerman is filling in. He's batting just 161. No extra base hits and three RBIs. There's a swing and a miss on the first pitch to Jerry Zimmerman. Yankees lead 2-0, top of the third. On deck is Dave Boswell. Downing's pitch outside, 1-1. Sun shining brightly here at Yankee Stadium. Downing gets the sign from Gibbs. Short windup. The curve is just inside. Boy, that is a sharp breaking curveball that Downing is throwing today. Two balls, one strike. The pitch, outside. 3-1. Downing looks down at Billy Martin. Rather, Zimmerman looks down at Billy Martin. Downing is working on the mound out there. Zimmerman is 6'2", 185 pounds. The 3-1 pitch. He lines one to center field. Pepitone digging to his left. Now back is there. One hands the ball. So Pepitone cutting the pie a little for the Memorial Day crowd. A ball that was really tagged, by the way, but Joe was there in plenty of time to two-hand it. But he figured to give the fans a little thrill.
Bill, did you ever notice how ball players are hams at heart? Get a big crowd, they go crazy.
Boy, I tell you, they're really all actors. Man, they know where every television camera is, every angle, and their best side.
You know, the one thing they ask when we're on the road, is this game going to be televised
back? Boy, they run in and shave and brush their teeth and comb their hair. Here is Boswell, who swings and misses a curveball, strike one. Boswell's batting 250, has one homer and one RBI. And he is wearing that protective helmet that covers his left ear and the left temple. A right-hand batter. Pitches outside, 1-1. On deck, Cesar Tovar. One out and nobody on in the top of the third. Yankees lead 2-0. Be a lot of baseball to report today. All the games in the American League, besides this doubleheader at the stadium, will be doubleheaders. Cleveland at Baltimore, Kansas City at Washington, California at Boston, Chicago at Detroit. There's a fastball right down the middle. One ball, two strikes. In the National League, the Mets are at Los Angeles tonight, St. Louis at Cincinnati tonight. There's a foul back out of play. St. Louis at Cincinnati, Philadelphia at San Francisco, and New York at Los Angeles, all single games. The rest are doubleheaders, which is Atlanta at Chicago and Houston at Pittsburgh. Again, the 1-2 delivery inside as Downing tried to throw the fastball by him. 2-2. Al has been very effective with his change of pace thus far. Here's the 2-2 delivery. A curve, ground ball hit hard. Bare hand catch by Amaro. Throw to first, they got him. Holy cow, Ruben Amaro, just like he was plucking cherries off a tree, had moved to his left, was in front of the ball. The ball took a bad hop, and Ruben just reached nonchalantly back with his bare hand, caught the ball cleanly, an easy toss to first, and they got him. Jerry, that's the second one I've seen Amaro catch barehanded this year.
Phil, he has a great pair of hands. There's no question about it. And I think as the season is going on, his leg is improving. And because of this, his range has improved.
Right. He's able to stop now and cut back to his right. Whereas before, when he was going in one direction, he had to keep going that way. Well, that was quite a play. And here is Tovar, struck out his first time up, takes a strike. The next pitch is a ground ball hit to third. Charlie Smith one-hands it. Fires to Mandalay, got the speedy Tovar. So it's a 1-2-3 inning for the Twins, and the score at the end of 2.5. The Yankees 2 and the Twins nothing.
Well, the action is coming at Yankee Stadium. A big weekend this coming week and one the following with the Tigers and the White Sox on hand. If you want to get tickets for the action coming up, you can do it at many places. At Macy's, located at Herald Square, Roosevelt Field, Queens, White Plains, and Huntington. The Chemical Bank New York Trust Company's 137 branches. Ripley Clothing Stores, 27 stores in the greater New York area. At the more than 30 Schraft restaurants. In the North Jersey AAA in Oradell, Patterson, and Jersey City. Or you can get them right here and right now today at the Yankees Advance Ticket Office, or at the Grand Central Yankee Ticket Office, or at the Port Authority Bus Terminal Ticket Office. The Port Authority and the Grand Central ticket offices are open daily 8:30 to 6 and on Saturdays 10 to 4. And the Yankee Advance Ticket Office here at the stadium open every day and after all night games. Or if you'd like, either get them in person or order by mail. We'll have more about that a little bit later.
The bottom of the third inning. The Yankees lead 2-0, and Al Downing will be the batter. Al, not a bad hitting pitcher. He's 3-for-13, one double, no RBIs, batting .231. From Trenton, New Jersey. I told you, Lauren Babe coaching at third today, and Frank Crosetti at first. The Crow favoring that bad knee, and he got hit with a bat out in Cleveland. The pitch to Downing is a curve over, strike one call. Strange thing about that, Jerry, that was a base hit that Vidal got too, wasn't it?
It helped beat the Yankees. That was the game where they went ahead 4-3 and finally went 5-3.
Fastball is high. No, he did swing. Downing tried to check it, but Frank Youmont says, no, you went far enough around.
Well, that was a strange thing about that bat incident, because when the bat went into the dugout, I instinctively followed the bat and forgot the ball. It was a base hit and didn't realize what had happened until I looked up.
Yeah, that would happen. There's a foul back, and the count's still nothing into it. It's just like Downing when Oliva threw the bat at two of those pitches. He didn't even follow the ball. Well, looks like we gave you some bad dope on the Indianapolis 500, but we'll tell you about it in a minute. There's strike three called on the outside corner. Downing called out on strikes. Strikeout number two for Boswell. On that Indianapolis 500, it was halted at the end of 18 laps and will resume today if conditions permit. All right, here's Horace Clark. Bounced to third his first time up. Boswell's pitch fouled back, out of play, off the upper deck and back onto the field. Clark trying to go to left field with Rollins playing him shallow at third base. Harris trying to slap one by him. Steve Whitaker homing in the second inning with Pepitone on, and the Yankees lead 2-0. Fastball bounce to second base. Carew one-hands it, flips to Killebrew for the out. We're seeing more and more one-hand plays on balls that ordinarily would be caught two-handed. Here is Tommy Tresh, who struck out in the first inning. Two quick outs, nobody on. What a beautiful day this is. You can come out and relax at the ballpark and enjoy the rest of this game and all the second game. Big curve gets away from Boswell. High and outside, ball one.
Phil, you know, you talk about catching the ball with one hand. Now, I think the gloves have done it. You know, when we were youngsters, they used to say two hands for beginners.
Right.
And with those gloves, you had to use two hands.
For sure. The glove was just about as big as your hand. There's a changeup curve over. Strike called, one and one. Well, there's no doubt that the gloves have played one of the big parts in why there are not as many 300 hitters in the majors. Some play, especially those third basemen. The curve almost hits Tresh low and inside, 2-1. On deck, Mickey Mantle. Boswell into the windup. Fastball is inside. Ball three, 3-1. Boswell thought he had that one. Boswell is another one of those young ball players who is very clever, very funny, does a lot of imitations, keeps the team relaxed. But again, like Whitey Ford, when he's on the mound, he's all business. Here's the 3-1 pitch to Tresh. Ground ball to first base. Killebrew has it and flips just in time to Boswell for the out. Killebrew could have taken that one himself. It's 3-up, 3-down. And the score at the end of three full innings, the Yankees 2 and the Twins nothing.
Bill, while we have our network with us, we'll take a look at the scoreboard. All of the action, as you mentioned, are doubleheaders in the American League, and these are first game scores only. Cleveland at Baltimore yet to start. It's Hargan against McNally. Kansas City and Washington, no score. Nash against Ortega, that's after 3.5. California leads Boston 4-0 after 3. Hall and Mincher have homered in that one for the Angels. Sanford against Santiago, relieved by Stang in the fourth. Chicago at Detroit will get underway a later start. Single games in the National League. The Mets are at Los Angeles tonight, an unusual circumstance. Philadelphia at San Francisco. St. Louis at Cincinnati. Those are single games, none of them as yet underway, and the Mets in L.A. will be playing this evening. First game of a doubleheader in Pittsburgh has been completed. The Astros beat the Pirates 3-2. The winner was Wilson. The loser was Rybant, relieved by Mickelson in the eighth. Staub had a sixth-inning home run in that one for the Astros. Second game, it's the Pirates 2. The Astros nothing after 2. Durker against Odell. And at Chicago, the Braves and the Cubs are going at it. The first game is Kelly against Jenkins. No score on that one. So the action is really just moving underway here in this beautiful Memorial Day doubleheader setting at Yankee Stadium. The Yankees lead 2-0 going in top of the fourth inning. Steve Whitaker's two-run homer in the second, the only scoring blow of the afternoon thus far. Scooter?
All right, Jerry, and here's Rod Carew, who dumped one into short left field for a two-base hit his first time up. A left-hand batter. Billy Martin flashing some signs, making Carew step back out of the batter's box. They might figure that Downing's had too many easy innings and might want him to throw a few more pitches. The only way he can do it is by taking. Here's the first pitch to Carew, and he bluffs a bunt, takes it low, ball one. Again, Carew looks down at Billy Martin. Downing into the windup. His pitch is fouled back in the upper deck, out of play. The banners are flying here today at Yankee Stadium, and they got some dandies out. Most of them about Mickey Mantle, of course. There's a bunt attempt down third, but foul. Boy, had he laid that one fair, it'd have been a base hit. So Carew at first has to come back. It's one ball, two strikes. And one of the signs is in two parts. They had to bring two flags. It says, "We're so proud of," and then an arrow points up to the second one alongside of it, "Mickey the Great." One ball, two strikes on Rod Carew. Nobody out and nobody on. Downing into the windup. His pitch is a little bit low. Two balls, two strikes. Even though Carew is a left-hand batter, Pepitone shades him ever so slightly towards left center field. Curve just missed outside. 3-2. On deck, Zorlo Versailles. Carew now picks up a little dirt. Wearing a golf glove on the left hand. Today is one day you really don't need the golf glove. Here's the payoff pitch. Check swing, ground ball, pass Downing. Clock in fast. Up with it, throws to Mantle. Just safe at first base. A very close call at first base, but first base umpire Bill Kinnaman called him safe. Carew trying to check his swing. It goes as an infield single. And right now on New York Yankee Baseball, it's paused briefly for station identification.
When people ask what station you listen to for modern, beautiful music and the New York Yankees, be sure to say WHN 1050 New York.
So Carew has the only two base hits off Downing. That one even softer hit than his double to left field, which he hit right off his fist. Well, that doesn't count as long as you get him. Here's Versailles, struck out his first time up. Takes a pitch low, ball one. Mantle holding the bag against Carew, who can really get down that line, by the way. Clark charged the ball, picked it up, didn't waste any time, threw quickly to Mantle. Mickey caught the ball with his foot on the bag, but they called him safe. One ball, no strikes on Versailles. Downing sets. Throw to first base, but Carew is back. Carew has one stolen base on the air. Downing ready again. Delivers a foul back of the plate. One ball, one strike. Ball was fouled right to Harmon Killebrew in the on-deck circle. Tommy Tresh playing deep and left and playing him for a pull hitter. Carew leading off first. Throw over there. He's back. Stretch by Downing. Another throw over there and he's back. Carew with a good lead at first. The pitch, swing and a miss at a good changeup. One ball, two strikes. Downing back to the rosin bag. Versailles takes his glasses off, rubs them on his uniform shirt, puts them back on. Nobody out. Yankees lead 2-0 in the top of the fourth inning. First game of the doubleheader. Stretch by Downing. Curve popped up in back of the plate. Gibbs charging back, coming back near the screen. He can't get it off the end of his glove, and then he crashed into the screen. Boy, the catchers are having trouble with these foul pop-ups in back of the plate.
Bill, that young Rod Carew is a man to be reckoned with, because he was tagging up on that play, and anybody that's young and has that baseball instinct that early, you've got to watch, because they'll learn to run the bases.
You're right, Jerry. And the way Gibbs was going at that ball, had he held onto it, he still would have crashed into the screen, which would have given Carew plenty of time to get to second base. So Versailles gets a life. There's no error on that play. They figured it was too tough a chance for Jake. The stretch by Downing. His pitch is fouled over our heads. Back into the crowd. Count holds at one ball, two strikes. Frank Fernandez from Staten Island, the young power-hitting catcher, has arrived. He's here today from military service. And he can be around for 15 days before he's activated. It's 1-2 on Versailles. Carew leading away. The stretch by Downing. The pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike three. For the second time, Versailles goes down on strikes, and it's the fourth strikeout for Downing. And here is Killebrew, who bounced hard to third base in the first inning. Real fine crowd on hand, but there's still good seats for you fans if you want to come out here. The stretch by Downing. His pitch is a little bit low as Killebrew had started a swing and held up. Ball one. On deck, Tony Oliva. Mantle holding the bag against Carew with one out. Downing's pitch, swing and a miss. A good breaking pitch, 1-1. Downing turns around, rubs up the ball. Outfield deep on Killebrew. Pepitone really deep in center field, a little bit towards left center. The stretch. The pitch is fouled back upstairs and out of play. Off the upper deck and back down on the field. Killebrew does not have that real level cut at a ball like, say, Tony Oliva. He kind of swings up at it a little bit, and that's what makes the ball travel so far and so high when he does connect. Downing ready, his 1-2 pitch. Change up, strike three, swinging. Beautiful motion by Al Downing for his fifth strikeout of the ball game. Killebrew way out in front, and here is Oliva, who bounced to second base in the second inning. Tony?
Bill, you think we've got a Sandy Koufax on our hands? Maybe Downing suddenly has found himself.
Jerry, if one game could be any indication, the game he pitched in Baltimore certainly could be it. And sometimes that's all it takes. Just like a hitter hits one ball on the nose or a couple in one game. Then you got the stride, the confidence.
Well, Phil, many people forget that Koufax went 6 years as a so-so pitcher before he hit his stride. And when he did, he really took off.
He certainly did. Two out. Yankees lead 2-0. Pitch to Oliva. Almost hit him as he goes down, loses the helmet and the bat. And it nicked him. It did nick him on his uniform shirt. And if you're going to get hit with a pitch ball, that's the only way to do it. Frank Grissetti, who was the master at getting hit with a pitch and not getting hurt, couldn't have done it any better than Oliva. And now it looks like it nicked Tony on the left elbow as he shows it to Big Jim Lemon. But it had to just graze him because Gibbs caught the ball. Like a foul tip. So Tony might wind up with a little water blister. Downing stretches. Pitching to Big Bob Allison. Swing and a miss. Strike one. Last night, the Dodgers beat the Mets 7-2. The Giants beat the Phillies 12-9. And the Reds beat the Cardinals 7-6. Cardinals won the first game 2-1. That was a doubleheader. In case you're like me and didn't get to read the paper this morning. Runners lead off first and second. Pitch to Allison. Swing and a miss on a changeup. Strike two. Carew at second, Oliva at first, two out. The Yankees leading 2-0, top of the fourth, and now Gibbs goes out to talk with Downing. And I tell you, Downing has these twin hitters shaking their heads. He is really mixing up the pitches beautifully, the changes of speed, the breaking pitches, and the fastballs. Allison struck out his first time up. Carew leads off second. Oliva with a big lead at first base. Two men are out. On deck, Rich Rollins. Stretch by Downing. His pitch, a breaking pitch, fouled off the umpire's chest protector. Count holds at 0-2. Frank Umont looking the ball over. Puts it in his pocket. 0-2, the count on Allison. Twins with good speed on the bases in Carew and Oliva. Downing with a long look for the sign. Still looking. And now he looks too long, and Gibbs calls time, as does Allison. Jake wants to go out and talk with Downing. Remember, with a runner at second base, they could be using the switch sign, and it might be confusing Downing. See, in a game the other day, the young Mets pitcher, Dennehy, said that's what Joe Torre was tipping the signs to Cleet Boyer. And that's how Cleet hit the home run. The two-strike pitch, the runners are going. The throw to third is high, and he's in there. Double steal, and as he overslid the bag, Smith went after to tag Carew again, and there was an unusual play, Jerry.
Phil, it came at a very unexpected time, and I think Charlie Smith got somewhat of a late start going in on the cover, and because of it, had trouble with the high throw. Had he been there at the bag, I think we might have had Carew as he went by.
You're right, and it was so unexpected that Charlie Smith was still deep as Carew was nearing third. Gibbs had the ball there in plenty of time, but then Charlie Smith had a reach high for the ball, still wasn't to the bag, and so a double steal is executed. It's one ball, two strikes on Allison. The pitch, strike three, swinging. Downing strikes out the side. Six strikeouts for Downing. What a job for the Twins. No runs, one hit, no Yankee errors, two men left, and at the end of three and a half, it's the Yankees two and the Twins nothing.
Say, here's a new kind of a card game where even born losers can win. It's called Flying Aces, and all you have to do to play it is to drop on in. There's nothing to buy, but there is plenty to win. Plenty of cash. Very green, very sweet, very free cash. And here's how you get it. Drive into a participating Flying Ace station, anyone will do, and somebody there will hand you a sealed envelope. Open it up, and you dig out two playing card halves. Match a pair, and you're a winner. From $1 to $2,500 is yours just for the spending. Flying Aces will give away two playing cards, plus an instant $1 winner, plus nothing to buy, plus a top prize of $2,500. So if you're driving around, play a hunch. Drive into a Flying Ace station for full details and do it right now. Like we said, Flying Aces is one card game even born losers can win. And if you're in the area, buy a Flying Ace station, drop in this minute. Void where prohibited.
We get ready now for the bottom of the fourth, and Mickey Mantle will lead it off. Mickey bounced out to second base his first time up. Amazing thing about Mickey, since being converted to first base, he started 34 of the first 37 Yankee games and has completed 23. Last year in the same amount of time, he only completed 9 playing center field. Pitch to Mickey, way high outside. Off the glove of the catcher, ball one. Mickey's top year for home runs was in 1961 when he hit 54. And right now he is one game ahead of that pace. The 1-0 pitch, slow curve, a little bit high, ball two, two and nothing. Yankees leading 2-0 in the bottom of the fourth. Outfield really deep on Mantle. The 2-0 pitch, inside, ball three, three and nothing. So it was off Boswell that Mantle homered in Minnesota the last time the Yankees were out there, and Boswell being very careful. The 3-0 pitch. Strike on the outside corner, 3-1. He's still being careful of Mantle, not trying to pitch in his power. Pepitone on deck. Here's a 3-1 pitch. Low, ball four. Mickey gets a base on balls. That's the first walk given up by Boswell in the ball game. Carew comes in to talk with him, and the batter is Pepitone. Joe lined a single to right field after being lucky on two foul pop-ups that Jerry Zimmerman could not locate right away. For Mickey, that's his 22nd base on balls of the year. He leads the Yankees in that department. Nobody out. Mick leads away. The stretch, the pitch to Pepitone is on the outside corner. Strike one call. Pepitone seems to be crouching more the day than at any other time during the season. He started the season straight up. The stretch. Fastball bounced to first, but foul, rolling down the right field line. Nothing and two. That Tovar is way over in right center field for Pepitone, too. Oh, I tell you, a line drive right up the middle, and Joe will have extra bases. Stretch by Boswell. Pitch is low, gets away from the catcher, and Mickey goes down to second base. Mick makes the turn and holds on, and it's a wild pitch charged to Boswell. He threw one that bounced in front of the plate, over the catcher's shoulder, and back to the screen. So the Yankees capitalized on a break in the second inning when, as we told you, Pepitone lofted two high fouls that Zimmerman couldn't locate and then eventually singled and was on when Whitaker homered. Here Mantle walks, goes to second on a wild pitch. It's one ball, two strikes on Pepitone. And now it's Joe's job to either drive Mantle in or at least pull the ball to the right side to advance him to third or hit one deep enough to the outfield where Mickey can tag up. These are the things that hitters like to do. They've got a job to do when they go out there. Here's the stretch. The pitch. Strike three swinging. He went after a bad pitch. Couldn't hold up. And that's the third strikeout, and here comes Whitaker. Mantle at second with one out. The Yankees two, the Twins nothing, bottom of the fourth. Whitaker hit an upper deck home run in the second inning. Stretch by Boswell. Slow curve is high, ball one. On deck, Jake Gibbs. Again, Tovar well over in right center field. Boswell stretches, checks Mantle. Curve is inside, and boy, Mickey had ideas that time. He had taken a good lead and broke just a little late. Stopped, trying to time Boswell's motion. Two balls, no strikes. Mickey with a good lead at second. The stretch. The pitch, swing and a miss and a high fastball, 2-1. And Boswell put a little extra on that fast one. Carew, the second baseman, is back on the outfield grass, well over in the hole. Here's the stretch. Fastball high and away, ball three, 3-1. Three balls, one strike, one out. Boswell looks in for the sign. He's ready, the stretch. The pitch, swing and a miss, and he took a little bit off that pitch. It's a full count now on Whitaker, 3-2. Tell you, he pitched right in Steve's power on the inside part of the plate and right around the letters. And we get set now for the payoff pitch. Boswell ready. Delivers a drive to center field. That's going to be in for extra bases. And it goes by the diving Tovar. Mantle scores. Whitaker is rounding second. He's going to go into third base with a stand-up triple. I tell you, Jerry, the way that Tovar is overshifting on these left-hand hitters, there was a ball that he would not have had a move for had he been in his regular position.
Phil, you called it, both with Pepitone and Whitaker up there. You said any ball hit into almost straightaway center field was going for extra bases. And although that had some mustard to it, it was hit way back there. It would have been an easy out had he been in a normal center field position.
Right. And now Versailles comes in to talk with Boswell. For Whitaker, it's his first triple of the year. Steve has now driven in all three runs the Yankees have with a two-run homer and a triple. He has driven in 15 runs. And now he's at third base with one out. The batter is Jake Gibbs, and the infield is pulled in for a possible play at the plate. And still Tovar, although not quite as far in right center as before, but still well in right center. Pitch to Gibbs. Ground ball. Foul outside of first. Just miss hitting the bag. Whitaker was almost in at the plate.
Phil, I can see where you can get a little bit, fouled up with a fellow like Boswell pitching. Primarily, he's a fastball pitcher, but when he throws his breaking stuff, it's very slow. And therefore, you've got to go one way or the other, and apparently the infielders and the outfielders are shading the pull on all these hitters.
You're right there, Jarrett. He just made a mistake. There's a curve popped in back of the plate, but back out of play. Steve Whitaker, who came into the game batting 262.
The Pirates, too, in that first ball game. The winner was Wilson, and the loser was Rybant, relieved by Mickelson in the eighth. Staub had a home run for the Astros in the sixth. In the second game, the Pirates lead the Astros 2-0 after two. Durker against Odell. And in a doubleheader at Chicago, first game, it's the Braves nothing and the Cubs nothing. Kelly against Jenkins. Right here at Yankee Stadium in this Memorial Day doubleheader, the Yankees are leading 4-0. Most of it due to the action of young Steve Whitaker, who in the second inning, with Pepitone on, hit his second home run of the year to drive in a pair. And then in the fourth inning, with Mantle at first base, who had gone to second on a wild pitch, Pepitone then struck out. Whitaker tripled, shading a little into left center on that triple, and then came in to score, and Gibbs singled to right. So right now, Ron Klein, the veteran reliever, has come on to do the pitching for the Minnesota Twins. Yankees are leading 4-0. We're in the bottom of the fourth inning. One out at first base is Gibbs. And I'll turn you back now to the scooter, Phil Rizzuto.
All right, Jerry. Last time Boswell pitched against the Yankees out in Minnesota, he worked 2 1/3 innings. Today, he worked one inning longer, 3 1/3 innings. He allowed 4 hits. He walked 1, struck out 3, and so far has been charged with 4 runs. Jake Gibbs at first is Dave Boswell's responsibility. Ron Klein coming on, making his 16th appearance, has 1-2, lost none. He's done a fine job for the Twins. Earned run average 2.84. He goes through his ritual. Delivers to Charlie Smith, almost hits him, ball one. Charlie bounced to first base in the second inning. Ron Klein, who when he's warming up, does not do any of this hocus-pocus stuff that he does on the mound. Now he goes to his forehead, peak of his cap, chest, belt, stretches. Delivers, it's popped up and back of first base in short right field. Carew waving Oliva away. And Carew makes an easy catch out of it. In short right field, that's the second out. And it brings up Ruben Amaro, who bounced to second base in the second inning.
Phil, if you put your finger on this Minnesota ball club, who right now are in fifth place, they're 6 games out. And I guess if you want to look at why they're in that position, a club that everybody thought might be a tough contender, Oliva batting at 200, and Jim Cott, who won 25 games last year, has a record of 1-6.
That's easy to figure out there, Jerry. That's for sure. All right, two out. The pitch to Amaro is high, ball one. Hey, how about Mike Epstein being traded to the Washington Senators?
That was a good trade for the Senators. They got a young left-hand pitcher who can throw, and they got Epstein, and they gave up their ace left-hander. Pete Rickard. But on the other hand, they got 2-for-1.
They sure did. Amaro bounces one, foul outside of third down the left field line, 1-1. So that'll break up the guessing game. And there was an unusual quote from Mike Epstein. He says, "I'm shocked. I didn't realize it would happen this fast." I don't know whether he was shocked because he went to Washington or whether he was shocked that he's back in baseball again.
Well, I'll tell you, he went from a contender to a club that isn't in contention in a hurry.
Well, that's for sure. I know Rickard was very happy to go with Baltimore, as who wouldn't be? I 1-1 the count on Amaro with two out, the Yankees leading 4-0. There goes the runner. The ball is fouled down the right field line and back into the crowd. And boy, Gibbs had some running jump that time.
Phil, you talk about Epstein and that trade. You know, when you're 30 and more and you're traded around... You don't mind hanging on in a ball club that's a contending club because you're not going anywhere anyway. But when you're young and you've never had a shot, the most important thing in your mind is the opportunity to play, whether it's a 10th place club, a 5th place club, or a 1st place club.
That's for sure. I think Michael realized that, but he's one of those real intelligent ball players. Sometimes they get in trouble when they think too much. There's a pitch low.
Didn't our famous catcher,
Yogi Berra,
quoted,
right,
"You can't hit and think at the same time"?
That's right. I remember Bucky Harris told him to go up there. Now, just think, this guy's got a good curveball, and Yogi took 3 pitches down the middle. And Bucky said, "What's the matter?" He says, "How do you expect me to think and hit at the same time?" So
So from then on, he let Yogi do anything. High and inside, 3-2.
Well, you know, it's true. The guys who think too much are the guys who end up with ulcers and go into those deep slumps. But the guy who can take it in stride never has a problem.
You're right. Just like golfers who start to think of stiff right arm, left hand, they end up with psychiatrists. I know a friend of mine goes to sleep with his 9-iron. There's a pitch on the outside corner. Strike 3 called. Amaro caught looking. So Klein does a fine job, but the Yankees come up with 2 more runs on 2 more hits. No twin errors, 1 man left, and at the end of 4, it's the Yankees 4 and the Twins nothing.
Jack Sterling could have an extra bonus for you tomorrow morning at 7:30. If Jack calls your Yankee schedule lucky number, you'll win 2 tickets to a Yankee game and maybe an extra bonus prize. But you'll have to keep your dial at 10:50 to hear Jack call your number. Get a free lucky number schedule while they last at any Yankee ticket office, at the stadium, Grand Central Station, Port Authority Terminal, at all Macy's Theater ticket outlets, Triple S Trading Stamp Redemption Centers, Schraff's Restaurants, Ripley Clothing Stores, and HFC Household Finance Offices, or by sending a stamped, self-addressed envelope to Yankee Contest, WHN, New York 22. You could be one of the next winners of 2 tickets to a Yankee game and a bonus prize, too. Listen for your lucky number every weekday morning at 7:30. Jack Sterling announces one tomorrow.
We get ready for the top of the 5th inning. The Yankees lead 4-0. They scored 2 in the 2nd and 2 in the 4th. And for the Twins now, Rich Rollins will lead off. Rollins popped to 2nd base in the 2nd inning. Al Downing on the mound. He has allowed 2 base hits. He has struck out 6. Has not walked anybody and has not allowed a run. Rollins steps into the batter's box. Adjusting his glasses. Now Downing ready. Here's his first pitch. Right down the middle, a good fastball, strike 1 call. Didn't they at one time have 4 men in the infield all with glasses, Jerry, or is this the club? Am I thinking the wrong club? I know they had Mincher, Versailles, Rollins. A ground foul right to Billy Martin. Nice play by Billy. Strike 2.
Bernie Allen and Quillacy didn't wear glasses at second base, and, I can't think, Phil. It was 3 out of 4 anyway. It could have been this club.
Anyway, I remember at one time kids were embarrassed to wear glasses playing any form of athletics.
Embarrassed? They wouldn't sign you.
No kidding?
Well, Dominic DiMaggio, you know, was one of the first to break that eyeglass rule that you couldn't hit without glasses.
Yeah, I remember he and Eddie Juice were about the only two I could remember for a long time.
Well, Juice got his after the war, but DiMaggio came up in 41 with his.
Right. The 2-strike delivery just missed outside. 1 ball, 2 strikes.
Maybe he came up in 1940, I guess. He was up a year ahead of you, wasn't he, Dominic? The Red
Sox? I think you're right, Jerry.
But nevertheless, you know, my dad, who played some semi-pro ball in his day, they wouldn't sign you if you wore glasses.
There's a line foul outside of third. Good play by the ball boy down the left field line. 1 ball, 2 strikes to count. Nobody out, nobody on. The Yankees leading 4-0 in the top of the 5th. On deck, Jerry Zimmerman. Downing with the short windup. Delivers a line drive base hit to right field. And he went right with that pitch. Whitaker is up with it. Rollins is on. And right now on New York Yankee Baseball, let's pause briefly for station identification.
There are more prizes for you to win in Jack Sterling's jackpot. Your name could be announced tomorrow morning at 7:15 here on WHN 1050, New York.
All right, Jerry Zimmerman the batter. Downing's pitch is low, 1. Mantle holding the bag against Rich Rollins. That was the 3rd hit. On the scoreboard, it says Whitey Ford, the top Yankee, with 498 games, 236 wins, 1,956 strikeouts. And there's a strike on the inside corner to Zimmerman. In case you hadn't heard, Whitey Ford officially announced his retirement today. Jerry and I were talking about it prior to the ball game. Whitey was introduced to the fans just before the start of the game and got a tremendous ovation. The chairman of the board is gone. Curve is low, two balls and a strike. As Jerry said, he's gone, but will never be forgotten, and he still will be working for the Yankee organization in many different areas. Might even find him up in the booth here once in a while, Jerry. Fastball off the end of the bat. Clark, up with it. Started for second, throws to first. One away. He had a shot for Rollins going into second base. And we're going to have a pinch hitter now, and it looks like Rich Reese will check that. A pinch hitter for Ron Klein coming up, and that's who it is. Rich Reese. Old Eagle Eye Coleman spotted him coming out of the dugout. Reese has been about 27 times, 7 hits. He has 3 doubles, 1 homer, 6 RBIs. Batting 259. Reese is 6 feet 3 inches tall and 190 pounds. From Ohio. Last year with Denver batted 327. Good looking young ball player. Downing sets. Delivers it, fouled back on the screen, strike one. You see a lot of unusual stances amongst ball players. Very few of them stand alike. This fellow holds his bat in an unusual way. Just before he gets set to hit. Here's the stretch. Holds it almost pointing down to the ground. The curve is in there. Strike two. In other words, he has it over his left shoulder, being a left-hand batter, but the barrel of the bat is pointing down towards the ground. And that is very unusual, because then he's got to straighten up and get that bat level before he swings. The two-strike pitch bounced off the plate foul over towards the Yankee dugout. I'll tell you one thing I noticed, Jerry, that Vidal, who had such an unusual stance here at the stadium when the Indians played, was not so unusual when we played them in Cleveland.
No, maybe Joe Adcock had gotten to him, because sometimes those extreme, unorthodox stances just don't hold up in the major leagues.
That's right. He really had one. Boy, he looked like he was going to run right back towards us. He was facing us, practically. Back of the plate. Swing and a miss. He couldn't check it. Strikeout number 7 for Al Downing on a good, fast, tight fastball. And the batter now is Cesar Tovar. Struck out in the first, bounced to third in the third. Rich Rollins at second base with two out. Yankees leading 4-0. Pitch to Tovar is a curve inside, ball one. Tovar batting 302. On deck, Rod Carew. They're not holding Rollins too close to the bag. He can take a big lead. The stretch, the pitch is popped up. Charlie Smith shading his eyes in foul territory, makes the catch. He hit that right off the end of the bat. For the Twins, no runs, one hit, no Yankee errors, one man left. And now, at the end of 4.5 innings, it's the Yankees 4 and the Twins nothing. Well, the Fresh Air Fund is alive and well. For the 90th year, the fund will send needy city children to free summer vacations in the country, but only with your help. So please send your contribution to Fresh Air, New York, 10036. That's Fresh Air, New York, 10036. Don't forget Old Timers Day, 21st annual one, honoring the player of the year involved in the memorable event of the year, and the Twins will be the attraction at the stadium, plus the newest members of the Hall of Fame. That's Saturday afternoon, August 19th. And Bat Day, when the official Little League bat with the autographed reproduction of the Yankee star signature, the Yankee team name made by the manufacturers of Louisville Slugger, given to all youngsters 14 and under, accompanied by an adult. Yankee Bat Day, in conjunction with a doubleheader with the White Sox on Sunday, June the 11th. So you better get those seats now. Well, we have a new pitcher coming on and also a new broadcaster, Mr. Garagiola, coming over from TV.
Thank you very much.
Well, it's kind of a sad day, Joe, wasn't it? Seeing old Whitey Boy, I tell you, it's hard to believe that he's not out there anymore. I know you went over to talk to him, and so did I. And, boy, you could just see the tears trying to come, but he was man enough to hold them back, and that's a tough job.
Sure is, and it wasn't just him either. Alston Howard, talking to him. Ralph Houck. Jim Rowland is the new pitcher for the Twins. Tough day. The only disappointment about the whole thing, Phil, is that he had those two operations, and the second one was so successful, and a bone chip that had been a thing he's had before and always went away, that was the thing that...
You're right. They were two major operations, and boy, to go through them, you got to have a lot of guts. But I guess the third one, just a little too much even for Whitey. And I guess when you get along that age, Joe, there's always some little thing or other that's come along make you feel uncomfortable.
Yep. A sad day for Yankee fans and Whitey Ford fans. Bottom of the fifth inning, Rowland, the left-hander, delivers to Al Downing, and it's a strike of fastball over the outside corner. One strike to count. Steve Whitaker, a big day. Two-run homer and a triple to drive in a run and scored the other one. He's figured in all four runs. Rowland delivers outside. One ball and one strike. There's his strike. One ball and two strikes. Rowland doesn't waste any time. This left-hander just grabs that ball and fires. 1-2 pitch now, on the way to Al Downing. Outside, and it's 2-2. Here's the 2-2 pitch now to Downing. Swung on and fouled right here. Get it, Phil! Uh-oh, we're going to hear an explanation of this.
Oh, Sandy had me blocked out. It went right over Sandy's head.
Swing and a miss by Downing, and he's out on strikes. Jim Rowland gets his first man, Al Downing, and that brings up Horace Clark, who bounced out third to first and second to first. Yankees lead 4-0. We're in the bottom half of the fifth inning. Horace Clark, he'll switch over, bat right-handed. Frank Umont pointed that there's no on-deck hitter, or the towel, rather. Pointing the on-deck circle, I'm looking for a hitter, and I see the two towels there. Look at him. Something's bugging him over there. It's pine tar rag, two towels, and a rosin bag. Clark fouls one off, and it's one ball and one strike. Yankees are leading 4-0. We're in the bottom half of the fifth inning. Jim Rowland. Washington on Howard's home run, leading Kansas City 2-0. We'll get to see Epstein, Phil.
Yep.
Next week.
How about that?
1-1 pitch. A line drive left field. Coming over is Allison and makes the play. Clark flies to Allison in left field. Two away. And brings up Tom Tresh. Tresh struck out in the first inning, bounced out. Killebrew to Boswell. That was in the third inning. Jim Rowland, the left-hander. Ready now. Here's the first pitch to Tresh. Curveball outside, ball one. Umont finally made the bat boy come out and get his laundry. He's got it all. Swing and a miss by Tresh, a high fastball, and it's one ball, one strike. So he gets to be a project to go up there and hit now with the pine tar rag, rosin, two towels, and a batting glove. Not to mention the bat. Outside, two balls and a strike. Rolling ready. Fresh weights, the pitch. Swung on, broken bat ground ball right to Rich Rollins. He's got it to throw in plenty of time. And Tresh is out, Rollins to Killebrew. Yankees in the fifth inning, three up and three down. The score at the end of five complete innings. It's the New York Yankees 4, the Minnesota Twins nothing.
Say, fans, how'd you like to win $2,500? Well, we'd like you to win. And how can you win? Well, just play Flying Aces. The exciting game now going on at your Flying Ace station. It's very easy to play and not very hard to win. All you do is drive into your participating Flying Ace station. Your Flying A dealer hands you a sealed envelope with two playing card halves. Match your pair and you're a winner. Anywhere from $1 to $2,500. Like Kenneth Clark of Newburgh, New York, who won $500. Or William Evans of Astoria, who is $100 richer. Or Raymond I. Booth of Wallingford, Connecticut, who came away $100 happier after visiting his Flying A dealer. They're just a few of the thousands of fans who've won money simply by playing Flying Aces. You can win, too. Just pull yourself out of your comfortable dugout there and get yourself into the game. Nothing to buy, yet you could be a winner, and we'd like that a lot. Get full details at Flying A and get into the game today. Void where prohibited.
Top half of the sixth inning, it'll be Rod Carew, Versailles, and Killebrew. Carew is 2 for 2. He doubled a left in the first inning, beat out an infield hit in the fourth. Al Downing has struck out 7. He has allowed 3 base hits, 2 to Carew and 1 to Rich Rollins. Baltimore 1, Cleveland nothing in the second. California 4, Boston nothing in the fourth. Home runs by Hall and Mincher. Houston beat Pittsburgh 3-2 in the first game. Pirates leading the second game 3-0. Atlanta 2-0 over the Cubs in the third. Downing gets his sign. Carew waits. Here's the first pitch of the sixth inning. It's a strike, a curveball. Carew shortened up as if to bunt, held back, but he caught the outside corner. 1 strike to count. Outfield shading Carew towards left center field. Swung on, little pop fly, chasing it Charlie Smith and Ruben Amaro, and Amaro makes the play. What a play he made, and that would have been a fair ball. The momentum carried Amaro all the way to the railing along the third baseline. It looked like there was going to be a collision between Charlie Smith and Ruben Amaro, and at the last minute, Amaro dropped his hands, caught that ball about belt high, and that would have been a fair ball as third base umpire Larry Knapp was indicating fair ball. A fine play, quick reflexes once again. You know, Amaro made a tremendous play on a bad hop where he caught the ball barehanded. And this one, at the last minute, he just flicked his glove, and there she was. One away, and here is Versailles. Bunted down the first baseline, but foul.
Sure, you know, that Carew making this game look easy. The first two hits, he got to hit one off his fist in his short left field. Then hit that slow ground ball and beat it out. And if that one would have dropped in, talk about scientific hitting.
He hits those flares.
Yeah.
Popped up in foul territory, and Mickey Mantle comes over. Makes the play, and he gets an ovation. Here is Harmon Killebrew. Killebrew bounced out third to first in the first inning and struck out in the fourth. Yankees 4, the Minnesota Twins nothing. We're in the first game of the doubleheader. Downing ready, delivers. High ball 1. Hey, Phil, that was a pretty good low bridge at Oliva last time up, huh?
Oh, man, I tell you. When that bat comes flying out towards the pitcher, that just shakes him up a little.
Here's a high drive, right field, going back. Whitaker near the wall. It is a home run, opposite field. Harmon Killebrew just hit one into the bullpen in right field. Whitaker got back there, but he ran out of ballpark. and Killebrew has just made a 4-1 ball game. Man, he hit that a long ways to the opposite field. Here is Oliva. Oliva hit by a pitch ball his last time up, bounced out second to first in the second. That was Killebrew's 10th home run of the year. He has driven in 31 runs. Foul ball, left side, upstairs, strike one. Nobody on, two men out, one run in, 4-1's the score. Yankees are leading, top of the sixth. Here's a pitch by Downing. Did it hit him? Yes, it did, hit by a pitch ball. And Oliva's on again. Stopped and started to say something and then decided against it. Oliva is on at first. And Allison is the hitter. He's been out twice on strikes. Mantle playing behind Oliva. Now they're motioning to hold him on. Time is called. Two men out. Downing at the belt. Checks the runner. Delivers. Swung on. It's popped up. Foul territory near the Yankee dugout. Jake Gibbs is over there and makes the play. Nice play by Jake Gibbs. Covered a lot of ground. Two fine plays in this inning, one by Amaro, one by Gibbs. That retires the side. One run on one hit. A home run by Killebrew. No errors. One man was left on base to score at the end of 5.5 innings. It's the New York Yankees 4, the Minnesota Twins 1.
Well, the sensational Kansas City A's, featuring the brilliant pitching of Jim Nash, Catfish Hunter, Blue Moon Odom, Lou Krause, and the brilliant reliever Jack Aikum, will make a solo initial visit to Yankee Stadium tomorrow night. That's Wednesday, May the 31st. And this is a new Kansas City club that manager Al Dock will bring in. Remember, June is always the big month at Yankee Stadium. The schools let out, the groups hold their final outings of the year, and summer arrives like it did today. And this year, the Yanks have an attractive June schedule. 19 games on 16 dates, including three great weekends, two with the colorful Detroit Tigers, and the other with the front-running Chicago White Sox. And with the White Sox at the stadium for a real bargain bill doubleheader, the Yankees will stage their annual Bat Day on Sunday, June 11th. Three doubleheaders in June, one on Sunday, June 4th with the Tigers, another with Gil Hodges, Washington Senators, a twi-nighter on Wednesday, June 7th, and June the 11th on Bat Day with the White Sox.
Mickey Mantle will lead it off here in the bottom half of the sixth inning against Jim Rowland. A good crowd on hand, a lot of the youngsters, and that's always excitement in the ballpark. Rowland is ready, delivers to Mantle. Strike is called, a big breaking curveball. Mantle bounced out, second to first in the first inning, walked and scored in the fourth inning. Fastball misses, one ball and one strike. Mantle came into the game hitting 246 with 11 home runs and 21 runs batted in. One ball, one strike. Jim Rowland delivers to Mickey Mantle. Swung on, a fly ball, right field. Oliva comes in and makes the play. Mantle hit the ball off the end of the bat and broke his bat. And Oliva hauls in the fly ball, so there's one away, and it brings up Joe Pepitone. Pepitone single to right field in the second, and he struck out in the fourth. He scored on the single when Steve Whitaker hit a two-run homer. Rowland, the left-hander, delivers. Swung on, a high fly ball, left center field. Bob Allison taking charge and makes the play. Say, taking charge, I used that a little bit loosely. He went at that at an angle.
He sure did. Allison has had a couple of fly balls that he surrounded. And yet, you remember that great play he made in the World Series? Oh. You did that game, Joe. Didn't you do that game?
Yeah, he slid on his belly in Minnesota.
Yeah.
Diving catch. Here is Steve Whitaker, who has been Jack Armstrong so far this afternoon. He's been the big man. Frank Umont indicates strike one. Ball hit Whitaker's bat. Whitaker, a home run in the second with a man on, a triple in the fourth with a man on, and he came on to score when Gibbs hit a single. One strike to count, two men out, nobody on. Rowland delivers. Swung on, a high drive, right field, near the line. Oliva's going back, near the wall, and makes the catch. Right up against the wall. Oh, boy, just one more biscuit this morning. He'd have had it into the first row. But it's 1-2-3. And the score at the end of six complete innings, it's the New York Yankees 4 and the Minnesota Twins 1.
We'll take a look at the scoreboard. Cleveland at Baltimore for a big doubleheader. At the end of 2.5 innings, it's all tied up 1-1. Hargan against McNally. Kansas City at Washington for a pair. At the end of 7.5, it's Washington 2, Kansas City nothing. Nash against Ortega. Frank Howard hit his 10th homer of the year in the fourth with one on. California at Boston for a pair in the first game. At the end of 5.5, the Angels 4, the Red Sox nothing. Kelso against Stang. Jimmy Hall homer in the second with one on, and Mincher in the third with one on for Mincher's 10th of the year. White Sox nothing, Tigers nothing, end of one. Peters against Wilson, first game for doubleheader. Mets at Los Angeles tonight, Philadelphia at San Francisco later on. Houston beat Pittsburgh in the first of two, 3-2. Wilson the winner, Rybant the loser, Staub homered. Second game, Pittsburgh 3, Houston nothing, end of 5.5. Lattman against Odell. St. Louis at Cincinnati tonight. Atlanta at Chicago for a pair in the first game at the end of 3.5. The Braves 2, the Cubs nothing. Kelly against Jenkins. So those are the scores of the other ball game here. It's the Yankees 4 and the Twins 1 in the top of the 7th, and back to Joe.
Okay, Phil, it'll be Rich Rollins to lead it off, Jerry Zimmerman, and a possible pinch hitter. We'll have to wait and see. Yankees are leading 4-1. Rollins popped to the second baseman in the second inning, and he singled to right field in the fifth. Rollins came into this game hitting 244. Al Downing has struck out 7. He has allowed 4 base hits. Here's the pitch. Fastball is a strike. Boy, a nice long homestand. A lot of exciting baseball on tap. Kansas City will be in tomorrow. Here's a pitch by Downing. Tries to bunt, misses it on a strike two. And then Detroit comes in Friday night, Ladies' Day, Saturday, Senior Citizens' Day. And all you ladies get out early to get the charm. Same charm that was given away on Mother's Day. While the supply lasts, they'll be giving them away. That's Saturday. And a doubleheader on Sunday the 4th, Detroit. Here's the two-strike pitch. Swung on, a high fly ball. Center field, Pepitone clicks the glasses and makes the play. Be interesting, Phil, to see what the crowd is in Detroit today, White Sox and the Tigers.
Yeah, that's right. They're battling for first place. Half game difference.
Then after the Tigers leave here, Washington comes in for 5 games on 4 days. We'll get to see Mike Epstein. Zimmerman pops one foul out of play. The on-deck hitter is Sandy Valdespino. White Sox will close out the homestand. And it's Ladies' Day again the 10th, and then Bat Day on the 11th. Doubleheader. Fastball misses, 1 ball and 1 strike. Downing ready. The 1-1 pitch to Zimmerman is foul back. Zimmerman fly to center and bounce to Horace Clark. That was in the fifth inning. Here's a 1-2 pitch, high curve, 2-2. Nobody on, 1 man out. Yankees 4, Minnesota 1. Here's a pitch. Swing and a miss, and Jerry Zimmerman is out on strikes. That's 8 strikeouts. And here is Val Despino. Val Despino. He and Walt Bond were fighting it out for the utility role. And the Twins decided on Val Despino. He's up there now batting for Jim Rowland with 2 outs in the 7th. Nobody on. Inside, ball 1. Downing delivers. Inside, ball 2. A stocky little guy. A little stumpy. Good power. Good power to the opposite field. Right down the middle of fastball. Downing has been getting behind hitters and yet comes right back. He has struck out 8. He hasn't walked anybody. 2-1 pitch. Curveball is a beauty. Tell you that he has really been snapping that curveball off. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs, top of the 7th. Here he comes again. A bouncing ball. Amaro's in a hole. Backhand. Long throw in time. Nice play by Ruben Amaro. 1-2-3 for the Minnesota Twins in the top of the 7th. The score at the end of 6.5 innings. It's the Yankees 4, the Twins 1.
Say, when you're visiting Yankee Stadium, be sure to take a little time to see the new Telefonic Hall of Fame in Lobby 6. There are more than 30 telephones are available, and you'll hear the voices and the deeds of all-time Yankee greats. And it really is quite an added feature at Yankee Stadium. Also, high school students, before the end of the school year, the Yankees will hold an attractive Geo Card Night. It's scheduled for Friday night, June the 9th, with the first-place Chicago White Sox. All high school students will be admitted to grandstand general admission seats on payment of the usual 50-cent tax and service charge. Just present your general organization card or parochial school identification card, and that's Friday night, June the 9th, GO Card Night. And another reminder that tomorrow night, Alvin Dark will be bringing in the Kansas City Athletics. Just a one-night stand. I'm sure you don't want to miss him. A lot of good young talent, and especially the brand new kangaroo white shoes. You'll really enjoy seeing them.
Looks like Jim Allum is going to be the pitcher for the Minnesota Twins. It is Jim Allum. It's a young left-hander. While he loosens up with his catcher, Jerry Zimmerman, right here on New York Yankee Baseball, we'll pause for station identification.
2 tickets to a Yankee game and a bonus prize are yours if Jack Sterling reads your Yankee schedule lucky number tomorrow morning at 7:30 here on WHN 1050 New York.
Jim Allum, the left-hander, continues to loosen up. It'll be Jake Gibbs, Charlie Smith, and Ruben Amaro in the bottom half of the 7th inning. Yankees are leading 4-1. On the scoreboard, happy birthday, Jim Farley, 79 years old today. And certainly all of us up here, our best wishes for many, many more. Been a Yankee fan for a long, long time, Mr. Jim Farley. Jake Gibbs against Jim Allum. Dave Boswell started. Klein came on. Rowland was on. Now Allum. Fastball is a strike. Jim Allum. When you talk about pitching deliveries, this guy has really got a good one. Curveball outside, 1 ball, 1 strike. It's not a rhythmic, smooth kind of a delivery. He seems to come at you in sections. He gets his sign, he swings his arms, goes up to his toes, momentary pause, and then zoop, there it comes. Way outside. Two balls and a strike. I used to hate to hit those guys that did all that.
They are tough to follow. And as you say, this guy's got three different times where he just about pauses.
Looks like there's a little part missing somewhere that would make it real smooth. Now they want to go over the signs. And Zimmerman says the same as they were in spring training, Jim. One's a fastball, two's a curve, three's a slow one. Okay. Those are some great meetings. You've been in on them.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not making that up. You know.
No, that's true.
It's like when you lead off an inning, you get to first base, and the coach tells you nobody out. 2-1 pitch. Popped up. Zimmerman can't find it. Here comes Rollins. Now Zimmerman takes charge and makes the play. For a minute, Zimmerman couldn't find it. He made the play. It was in fair territory. Here is Charlie Smith.
Must be that kind of a day for the catcher, Joe. He had trouble on two. Pepitone popped up, and then Gibbs had trouble on one.
Well, he's breaking bad. I got to believe that it's a little case of blinking going on where you're not seeing the ball come off the bat. Because on that first one on Pepitone, he broke the wrong way.
Yeah.
Ball one. You could really see it on the replay. I want to make sure. He broke to his left and then went around. One ball, no strikes. There's a foul ball, straight back, out of play. Nice catch by a spectator. You know, I said on television side, when those foul balls go like that, if you don't see them go off the bat, they always tell you to go to the power side. For example, a right-hand hitter, you would break to your left. A left-hand hitter, you break to your right if you don't see it come off the bat. If you can think of it, too. Way inside. Two balls, one strike. Because usually the foul ball will go that way. And Bill Maher added one more. He said if you break the wrong way or you don't go to the power side, grab the umpire. Make it look like he got in the way. Two balls and one strike on Charlie Smith. Here's the pitch. Good fastball. Swing and a miss by Smith. That's all of them. He struck out 137 men in 1966 at Denver. Won 20 and lost 8. 2-2 pitch. Tap foul. Boy, he hasn't been pitching much at all. Certainly a strikeout pitcher. In 63, he struck out 100. 64, 131. 65, 125. 66, 137. High, ball three, all the way back to the screen. Three balls, two strikes. Yankees lead 4-1. Olam ready, 3-2 pitch to Charlie Smith. Swung on, a foul tip, held on to by Zimmerman. And there's a strikeout for Jim Olam. And here is Ruben Amaro. Amaro bounced out, second to first in the second, and he struck out in the fourth. And he has put on quite a show with the glove. And with the bare hand. He made quite a play on a bad hop. Ruben hitting 290. Jim Olam delivers to Amaro. It's high, ball one. One ball, no strikes. Two men out, nobody on. Olam's pitch. Outside. Two balls, no strikes. Outfield, even though Amaro is a right-handed batter, playing him as if he were a left-handed hitter. Here's a 2-0 pitch. Line drive left field. Allison going back. He's there. Makes the catch. The ball was well hit. So it's 1-2-3 for the Yankees in the bottom of the seventh. And the score at the end of seven complete innings. It's the New York Yankees 4, the Minnesota Twins 1.
You know, I wish they wouldn't keep changing the Flying Aces winners' names in these scripts. Some names are hard to pronounce the first time around. So all of us practice them before we go on the air. But by the time we get them right, we get a new list of winners. But I'll tell you, I hope we get the chance to mispronounce your name. Because if we do, it means you've won money playing Flying Aces. Those Flying Ace people are really dealing out the cash. And can you think of an easier way to win up to $2,500? All you have to do is drive into a participating Flying Ace station, ask for an envelope. The attendant will hand you a sealed envelope with two playing card halves inside. Match your pair and you win. The more often you play, the better your chances are to win. There's nothing to buy, so after the game, go see your nearby Flying A dealer. Maybe you'll win the $2,500 jackpot like Edward Lanza, or the $1,000 prize like Gisela Lutz did. And there are thousands of dollars still to be won, maybe by you. Get full details at Flying A. Void where prohibited.
We move into the top half of the eighth inning. Yankees are leading 4-1. And Phil, is going to be a little bit of a pregame, or between games, rather, ceremony. Joe Pepitone is going to be honored with the Gold Glove Award. And I guess because I never got one, I'm going to have the privilege of introducing the men who will present it to him. So I'll head down. And if you'll be so kind as to describe the last innings, let's put it that way, we'll all be happy.
All right, Joe, and good luck with the other Joe. Here is the first pitch bunted. Clark coming in fast. He anticipated. Flips the mantle for the out. Beautiful anticipation by Horace Clark with Cesar Tovar up there. And had he not been charging in as Tovar bunted the ball, it'd have been a base hit. But Clark made it an easy play, and it's one away. Tovar now 0-4. Here is Rod Carew. Doubled softly to left, single softly to second. And then popped out softly to shortstop, but Amaro had to make a spectacular play to rob him of a base hit. He has not hit the ball hard, but he's been placing it beautifully. One out. The Yankees lead 4-1. We're in the top of the eighth inning. The first pitch is low ball one. Big Frank Howard has just hit his second homer of the ball game, his 11th of the year in the eighth inning, this one with the bases loaded. And Washington leads Kansas City 6-0 at the end of eight. The pitch is fouled back out of play. One ball, one strike. Smith is in at third. The pitch is trying to bunt down third, and Smith anticipated that one, but it goes foul. One ball, two strikes. One out and nobody on. Yankees scored two in the second. Two in the fourth. Steve Whitaker has a two-run homer and an RBI triple. Jake Gibbs drove in the other run for the Yankees. Harmon Killebrew hit a solo homer in the sixth inning. The 1-2 pitch is popped to short left field again. Another trouble spot. And it drops in for another base hit. How do you like this Carew? You talk about treating that baseball gently. He has done it four times today and has gotten three hits. You talk about Wee Willie Killer. His great saying, hit them where they ain't. Well, Carew has been doing that all day. And only because of a great play by Amaro keeps him from having 4-for-4. But in the box score in tomorrow's paper, they'll all look like line drives. Boy, I tell you, what a stroke that is. Mantle will hold first against Carew. Here is Visayas. Struck out in the first, struck out in the fourth, popped to first in the sixth. One man out. And Carew is now up to 331 with his 3-for-4 today. There's a curve, low ball one. On deck is Harmon Killebrew. Yankees try not to have anybody on base when he comes to bat. They need a double play right here. The stretch by Downing. The pitch to Visayas is high ball two, 2-0. Al goes to the rosin bag. One man out. Carew leads off first. Downing sets. Kicks, delivers. He started a bunt, held back, and it's a strike called on the outside corner. 2-1. Right hand hitting, Zoilo Versailles asks for time at the plate. Downing taking too much time. Now Versailles takes a deep breath, steps back into the batter's box. Downing sets. The pitch, ground ball to third. Smith has it. Fire at the clock for one. Back to first. They got the double play just when they needed it. Beautiful play started by Charlie Smith on a hard hit ground ball. And for the Twins, no runs, one hit, no Yankee errors, nobody left. And the score at the end of 7.5. The Yankees 4 and the Twins 1. Well, don't forget, we have many special group days coming up at Yankee Stadium. Friday night, June the 2nd, is Union County night. Sunday, June the 11th, Danbury, Connecticut Day, as well as Bat Day. Saturday night, June 24th, is Parkchester, New York Day for all the fans in the nearby Parkchester area. And Sunday, June 25th, Milford, Connecticut Day. Cities and groups and any school, social, fraternal, business, or church organization can arrange a special day or night at Yankee Stadium. All you have to do is write the sales promotion manager at Yankee Stadium, and your group will be in for a wonderful outing together. The first edition of the Yankee Yearbook is sold out, and when the club, well, they are home now, fans will be able to buy the first revised edition, or you can order by mail. Send 65 cents, including postage, to Yankee Yearbook, Bronx Central Post Office, Box 1967, Bronx, New York. Al Downing getting a big hand as he'll be the leadoff hitter for the Yankees here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Al Downing's been up twice, struck out both times, but he still is not a bad hitting pitcher. He's facing the big left-hander Jim Olam, who is the fourth Twin pitcher in the ballgame. Here's his first pitch to Downing. Outside, ball one. Al, 5'11", 183 pounds. Born in Trenton, New Jersey. Now lives in Jamaica, Long Island. Olam's next pitch, swing and a miss, 1-1. Here's the 1-1 delivery. Right called a good fastball. And I tell you, this Olam is really tough to pick up. You talk about Satchel Paige's hesitation pitch. This guy's got three different spots where he comes to a complete stop. Curve is in there. Strike three called, and Downing knew it, walks away. Second strikeout for Olam, and it brings up Horace Clark. Horace is 0-3. Bounced to third base in the first inning, bounced to second base in the third, and fly to left field in the fifth. The Yankees 4 and the Twins 1 in the first game of the doubleheader. Another big one to go after this one. Still plenty of time to come out and see it. Fans really enjoying themselves here today. Sun shining brightly. The pitch to Clark. Outside, ball one. On deck is Bill Robinson, who will be batting for Tommy Tresh. Looks like Tommy's legs are aching again. There's a high pop-up near the Yankee dugout. Zimmerman coming over, has the room and makes the catch. And the ball boy very smartly picked up his stool and ran out of his spot there in the corner of the dugout. So it's two away, and here is Bill Robinson, who will be batting for Tommy Tresh and stay in the ball game. So Bill Robinson, youngster who is really having a rough time getting on track. Bill batting 111. He's 8-for-72. Two doubles, one homer, two RBIs. Right-hand batter. Olam's pitch is lined to right field, but coming in is Oliva. He's there and makes the catch. So it's three up, three down for the Yankees, and the score now at the end of eight full innings. The Yankees 4 and the Twins 1. Well, you know, the Yankees have received dozens of letters from women asking how they can obtain the Yankee charms that were given out at the stadium on Mother's Day. Well, there is a sufficient supply remaining that the Yankees will distribute. And while the supply lasts, on the very next Ladies' Day, which is this coming Saturday, June the 3rd, when the powerful Detroit Tigers play at Yankee Stadium, the Mother's Day Yankee gift charm will be given to all women attending the Ladies' Day game at Yankee Stadium on Saturday, June the 3rd. So here's a double bargain, a ticket to the Yankee game, just the 50-cent tax and service charge, admits women to grandstand general admission seats, and the Yankee charm. So girls, here's a Ladies' Day you won't want to miss. It'll be a big day. And of course, the Tigers are in for that big weekend. Friday night, Saturday, and a big doubleheader on Sunday. Bill Robinson, who, as we said, pinch hit for Tommy Tresh, stays in the ballgame to play left field, and he is quite a defensive outfielder. And for the Twins, it'll be Killebrew, Oliva, and Allison. Three of their real power hitters to face Al Downing here in the top of the ninth, the Yankees leading 4-1. Harmon Killebrew bounced to third in the first inning, struck out in the fourth, and homered into the Yankee bullpen in right center field in the sixth. For Killebrew, it was his 10th homer of the year and his 31st run batted in. Here's Downing's first pitch. It's high ball one. Curveball is low and it's ball two, 2-0. Killebrew steps back to look down at Billy Martin. Here is a fellow who 99 and 9-tenths of the time is hitting on his own. He doesn't have to look for a take sign or a bunt sign. He takes a strike this time, though. Two balls and a strike. Very seldom do you see hitters like Killebrew or Mantle or Mays or Clementi taking strikes. The 2-1 pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike two. Man, what a cut he added that one. Wind is blowing out today here at the stadium. You got to hit them high to take advantage. The 2-2 pitch, change up is low, and it's 3-2. Downing gets the sign from Gibbs. The payoff pitch is popped up. Charlie Smith and Ruben Amaro. Smith calls for it near the mound, makes the catch, and it's a big out here. Out number one in the top of the ninth inning. And it'll bring up Tony Oliva. Tony bounced to second base in the second inning, then was hit with a pitch ball in the fourth and hit with a pitch ball in the sixth. He wants Umont to take a look at the ball. Frank does, flips it back to Downing. If you remember, in the second inning, Oliva twice threw his bat at the ball, trying to hit the ball, and twice almost hit Downing as the bat spun right past the mound. Tony, who has been injured most of the year, batting 204, and that is a very unusual spot for Oliva, who is a natural 300 hitter. He'll be up there before the year's out. Downing's pitch, a ground ball hit hard right at clock. He boots it, and he cannot make the play. It was a hard hit ground ball right at Horace Clark. He got down on one knee, but the ball caromed off the heel of his glove, and he was not able to get it in time, and Oliva's on an error charge to Clark. That brings up Bob Allison. That's the first error of the ball game for either team. Allison struck out in the second inning, struck out in the fourth, fouled the catcher in the sixth. One man out, top of the ninth. Yankees lead 4-1. Downing delivers a bunt attempt. He drew the bat back. It's ball one. Gibbs thought he had bunted all the way. On deck, Rich Rollins. Oliva leading off first base. Downing sets. The pitch is high. Ball two, 2-0. Outfield straight away on Allison and deep. Downing leans over for the sign. Now he stretches. The fastball is low. Ball three. And this is the first time Downing has been this far behind on a hit of 3-0. He has not walked a man in the ballgame. Several times he's been 2-0 and 3-2. He stretches, delivers, and it's ball four, and that's the first walk given up by Downing. And Ralph Houck now is running out to the mound. He wants to make sure that Downing's all right, and he's going to talk to both Gibbs and Downing. And a very inopportune time for a base on balls, because it brings up the potential tying run of the plate in the person of Rich Rollins. The Yankees lead 4-1, but Houck's letting Downing in there. He just wanted to check, make sure he was not losing any of his speed, and that was just the base on balls that Downing was due for. He had not walked anybody, as we said, in 8 1/3 innings. So Oliva's at second, Allison's at first. Rich Rollins popped to second in the second inning, lined a single to right in the fifth, fly to center in the seventh. Rollins has 3 doubles, no home runs this year, 10 RBI. This is the top of the ninth inning. Do or die inning for the Twins. They trail by 3, but they have runners at first and second with 1 out. Al Downing gets the sign from Jake Gibbs. He stretches. Delivers a ball pulled deep but fouled back in the upper deck. Downing threw a slider right in on the fist of Rich Rollins. A lot of pitchers use that style to get ahead of a hitter, but you got to make sure it's plenty far enough inside. Rollins tugging at his pants, at his glasses, at his belt, kicking the dirt. Always a little nervous in that batter's box. He crowds the plate, a right-hand batter. Right up on top of it, stretched by Downing. The pitch, changeup, foul back upstairs, out of play. Nothing into the count. Downing was using his change of pace quite a bit in the first 5 innings. He hasn't used it too much in the last 4. Al had 8 strikeouts, had 7 in the first 5 innings, got 1 in the 7th. Runners lead off first and second, nothing in 2, the count on Rollins. Downing stretches. The pitch is a little bit high. Rollins almost went after it, just did hold up. Jake Gibbs rubs up the ball. Baltimore leads Cleveland 2-1 at the end of 4. Washington 6, Kansas City nothing, end of 8. The Angels and the Red Sox tied 4-4, end of 7. White Sox 1, Detroit nothing, end of 2. Houston won the first game from the Pirates 3-2. Pirates lead 3-0, end of 7. And the Cubs lead Atlanta 3-2 after 5. Downing's curve is hitting the center field for a base hit. Oliva will score. Allison is going to third base. And the throw comes into second base. It's a 4-2 ball game. And Rollins hit that ball right off the end of the bat. And here comes Ralph Houck, and that's going to be all for Al Downing. Downing, who has really pitched a great ball game. The Twins have 6 base hits. 4 of them have been bloop hits. 1, the home run by Killebrew, is well hit. And the line single by Rollins in the 5th inning. But the other 4 were handle hits and off the end of the bat. But it's the second trip to the mound for Ralph Houck here in the ninth, and that's all for Downing. So while we're waiting for the new pitcher to come on, we'll take a complete look at the scoreboard now. At the end of 4, the first game of doubleheader, all doubleheaders in the American League, it's Baltimore 2, Cleveland 1, Hargan against McNally. Washington leading Kansas City 6-2, playing the top of the ninth inning, as Phil Roof has just homered in the ninth with 1 on. It's Krause against Baldwin. Frank Howard has had 2 homers, 1 with 1 on and 1 with the bases loaded. So Howard has driven in all 6 runs for the Senators. Dooley Womack is coming on for the Yankees. It's the Angels 4 and the Red Sox 4 at the end of 7. Kelso against Osinski. Hall and Mincher have had 2 run homers for the Angels. White Sox 1, Tigers nothing, and a 2.5. Peters against Wilson. In the National League, the Mets and the Dodgers play tonight. Philadelphia at San Francisco, a later start. Houston beat the Pirates 3-2 in the first of 2. Wilson the winner, Rybant the loser. Staub homered in the 6th. Pirates 3, Houston nothing, into 7 of the 2nd. Ramond against Odell. St. Louis at Cincinnati tonight. And in the first of 2, the Cubs 3, the Braves 2 at the end of 5. Carroll against Jenkins. So Dooley Womack comes on now to try and put out the fire. Al Downing pitched 8 1/3 innings. He allowed 6 hits. He walked only one man. That was here in the ninth. He struck out 8, has been charged with 2 runs, but the runners at first and third are Downing's responsibility, which means that Downing definitely cannot lose the game, but could be the winning pitcher if Womack can get the side out. So Dooley Womack will be the pitcher. And Russ Nixon is coming on a pinch hit. Russ Nixon, a left-hand batter, will bat against Dooley Womack. Nixon has been up 32 times, 6 hits, has 1 double, 2 RBIs, batting 188. Dooley Womack will be making his 17th appearance of the year, the most of any Yankee. He's won 3 and lost 2, and his earned run average is 1.90. He's worked 23 2/3 innings, allowed 20 hits and 5 earned runs. So left-hand hitting Russ Nixon up there. One run in. The Yankees lead 4-2 in the top of the ninth. There's one out. Allison is at third base. Rich Rollins at first. The Yankee infield in double play depth. Nixon, though a left-hand batter, is not too fast. Here's the pitch. It's low and outside, ball one. Jim Olam is in the on-deck circle, but we'll have a pinch hitter for him. Runners lead at first and third. Stretch by Womack. His pitch is low and inside, ball two, 2-0. Two of the toughest jobs in baseball right now. Nixon going in as a pinch hitter after sitting on the bench for 8 1/3 innings, and Dooley Womack going in as a relief pitcher after 8 1/3 innings. Here's the stretch by Womack. Low and inside, ball three, 3-0. And Womack decides he wants a new baseball. Dooley falling behind, 3 balls, no strikes. Al Downing, who had really held the Twins in check up till this ninth inning, and an error started everything. The only error of the ball game is Clark booted a ground ball. Now you know Nixon will be taken all the way. Womack lays it right in there, and it's a strike call, 3-1. Nixon looks down at Billy Martin, who's looking at Sam Mealy, flashes the signs. I would have to guess he'd be taken right here to try to load them up, get the potential tying run to second. Here's a stretch by Womack. The pitch. He hits a ground ball to first. Mantle up with it. Goes to Womack in time to get Nixon. A run scores. It's a 4-3 ball game, and Rollins goes to second base. And how wrong I was. They let Nixon swing away, but Mantle made a fine play leading Womack to the bag. That's a run batted in for Nixon as Allison scores. That run is charged to Downing. And now there are 2 out. The potential tying run at second base in the person of Rich Rollins. And we're going to have a pinch hitter now. Let's see who's coming up. It's number 11 on the scorecard. Number 11, Ted Ulander, who is a left-hand batter, is coming up to face Dooley Womack. Ted Ulander, who is listed on the scorecard as 16, is wearing uniform number 11. Ulander, not considered a power hitter. He's a spray hitter, the line drive variety type. He's 9-for-38, has 2 doubles, 1 triple, 1 homer, 5 RBIs, batting 237. So this is it. Tension packed right down here in the final out of the top of the ninth. The pitch to Ulander is low, ball one. Dooley Womack in relief of Al Downing. Rollins with a big lead off second base. The Yankees lead 4-3. Womack sets. His pitch, swing and a foul back, strike one. He had a good cut at that. And right now on New York Yankee Baseball, let's pause briefly for station identification.
When people ask what station you listen to for modern, beautiful music and the New York Yankees, be sure to say WHN 1050, New York.
All right, Womack with a new baseball. Gets the sign from Gibbs. Here's the stretch. The pitch just missed the outside corner. Two balls and a strike. Gibbs and Womack thought they had that pitch. Two balls, one strike, two out. Yankee outfield not too deep on the left hand hitting Ulander. He chokes up on the bat. Rollins leads off second. Womack kicks, delivers, a ground ball hit to third. Charlie Smith up with it. Fires to middle. The ball game is over. Dooley Womack does the job. The Twins come up with a run on one hit. One Yankee error, one man left. The ball game is over. The final score, the Yankees 4, the Twins 3. Say, how'd you like a chance to win some money? Up to $2,500 worth. I'm talking about that wild card game, Flying Aces. The game that's really paying off in cash. There's lots more money to be won at Flying A. Mario A. Pollini from Malvern, New York, drove into a participating Flying A station, and he won $2,500. And that's not all. Timothy McMahon happened by a Flying A station in South Norwalk, Connecticut, and won $100 like that. Howard S. Robertson from Mineola, New York, listened and decided to play Flying Aces, and you guessed it, another $100 winner. So come on, lots of people really are winning money. Just drive in, get two playing card halves in a sealed envelope, match them and be a winner. Nothing to buy. Full details at Flying A. Play Flying Aces. Get rich and win up to $2,500. Void where prohibited. Well, the totals in the ballgame in a very exciting first ballgame it was for the Yankees. Four runs on just four hits and one error. For the Twins, three runs on six hits and no errors. The winning pitcher, Al Downing, and what a game he pitched. He has won five and lost three, a save by Womack. The losing pitcher, Dave Boswell, he has won one and lost three. The Yankees started the scoring in the second inning when Pepitone singled, and then Steve Whitaker hit an upper deck home run for two runs. In the fourth inning, with Mantle at first base, Whitaker tripled to deep center field to drive in Mantle. Then Jake Gibbs singled to drive in Whitaker. That was all the scoring for the Yankees. The Twins were shut out till the sixth when Harmon Killebrew, with two out, hit an opposite field home run. They picked up two runs in the ninth inning. Pardon me, I said one run. They picked up two runs in the ninth when, with one out, Horace Clark booted Oliva's grounder. Allison walked, the only walk given up by Downing. Rawlings singled to center to drive in a run, Allison going to third. Russ Nixon pinch hitting, bounced to Mantle, a run scored, and then Ulander bounced to third base, and that was the ball game. An exciting ball game and another big one to go. This program is authorized under rights granted by the New York Yankees solely for the entertainment of our audience, and any publication, reproduction, or other use of the descriptions and accounts of this game without the express consent of the New York Yankees is prohibited. Today's first game broadcast has been brought to you direct from Yankee Stadium by the G. Kruger Brewing Company of Cranston, Rhode Island. The brewers of Kruger Pilsner will never be able to say they brew the most, but they don't mind as long as they can say they brew the best. And by your participating Flying A dealer, where you can win up to $2,500 playing Flying Aces. Now, we'll be back shortly with the second game of this Memorial Day doubleheader with the Twins. We hope you'll join us then for more New York Yankee baseball. And now, stay tuned for beautiful music, news, and sports on WHN 1050 New York.
This is something that you hate to see happen, but I hope that I can stay with the organization, the same as Whitey, and help some of the other young players that come in and keep up this tradition as winning with the Yankee Ball Club.
Well, what made Whitey so different, Ellie? Was it the way he reacted after, say, an error, or was it the way he reacted after a tough loss, or what made him so different?
Well, I tell you one reason, Joe. I give a great deal of credit to Whitey. He taught me a lot about catching, being a pitcher that knew a great deal about the league. But I can recall playing in a World Series game that I played first base in 1957. I made an error on a double play ball from Gil McDougall of Coleman to me, and I dropped the ball, and he came over to me. I was picking the ball up, walking back to the mound. He said, "Ellie, look, forget about it. I'm going to bear down this next guy," and he struck the next belly out. So then, again, in a lot of ball games where you see a lot of young fellas, they make errors. And a lot of pitchers might have a tendency to get a little mad. But Whitey is one fella, he'll come back to the bench, and he'll talk to him, tell him, forget about it, we go out and get him the next time. And this is a thing that give a pitcher, a ball club, a tremendous lift. And that's why I say he's great for a ball club.
Well, Ellie, it's a big tribute you just paid him, and I thank you for taking time out to pay tribute to Whitey Ford, a Yankee who retired.
Well, Joe, I'm very glad to pay because this man is one of the finest I've ever met.
Thank you very much, Ellie. And we'll be back with Jerry Coleman and Steve Hamilton right after this message.
Hi, Jerry Coleman here, and today we're talking to Steve Hamilton, the fine relief specialist for the Yankees, who joined the Yankees in 1963 from the Washington Senators. And Steve, it's awfully nice to have you once again on our show.
Well, Jerry, it's always a pleasure to be here. Certainly glad to be here this year. We've gotten off to a pretty good start, and I feel like we're going to do all right. So, as I say, I'm certainly happy to see you again.
Steve, let's talk a little bit about a job that you have that doesn't relate directly to the baseball field. It's the behind-the-scenes activity as the player representative. And a lot of things are happening in that area. How about bringing us up to date on some of the more important aspects of it?
Well, actually, the most important undertaking that we have done the last year as player representatives has been to improve our pension plan, our benefits that we receive from it, and our hospitalization plan. We feel that what happens to a ball player when he gets through is of utmost importance nowadays, just as it is in other fields. And we feel that now we have worked out a retirement plan where baseball can certainly compete with the other industries and other professions. And we feel like the improvement of the plan this past winter, actually we doubled all the benefits. We felt like this is the most important thing that we've had to undertake, and consequently we spend most of our time on this, and we feel like we've done a pretty good job on it.
Steve, give me some specifics. What can a man get as a maximum pension right now?
Well, a maximum pension would be at age 65 with 20 years service in the big leagues, and he would receive somewhere around $17,000 a year at age 65 on retirement, so that's pretty good. That's more than a lot of us make right now.
Steve, talking about your job as a player representative, I noticed early this year that there was some comment about a game that was played in Minnesota when the game started at 32 degrees temperature and finished at 29, and a lot of quotes were thrown around, and I think that you, as the player representative for the Yankees, in representing their particular viewpoint, were much opposed to this type of play that early in the year under those circumstances.
Well, Jerry, actually, I think most ball players, and for that part, most of the administration in baseball would be opposed to playing a game in freezing and sub-freezing temperatures. Now, the rain or the snow or any adverse conditions where we'd have precipitation of some sort would naturally take care of itself. You wouldn't have to worry about it. And in most cases, the management has been responsible enough to call off a game that could be played in cold weather. I don't have to tell you as a ball player what could happen to you in cold weather, especially a pitcher. Major leagues invest a lot of money, the teams do, and their players. So consequently, you'd hate to lose a property which is worth a lot of money to you. Just as an industry, you'd hate to break down a very efficient machine which you had a lot of money in. And this can happen in the weather where it's 28 degrees with a 17 mile an hour wind, which makes the temperature somewhere around zero or close to it. So we feel like as ball players, our first responsibility is to the management and playing ball. That's what we get paid for, and that's what we like to do. We also feel that the management has a responsibility toward the players to keep them from being injured, because it's our career that we end. Although it could hurt the management, we're the ones that suffer in the long run. So I feel like, and most of the ball players do, and especially the representatives on the other teams that I've talked to, feel like that now it may be necessary to put a rule in which says that no games should be played below a certain temperature. And we feel like 40 degrees would be a good breaking off point here. I don't feel it's unreasonable, and I feel that when you do have a general manager who's irresponsible, and who would play for a financial gain, however small it's going to be, then it becomes necessary to do something about it.
Steve, as a player representative, does this job take up a great deal of your time, or is it something that you can do with ease, or is it something that taxes you?
Well, Jerry, I think it depends on how much time you put into it. It can take a great deal of your time, and in the past year, it has taken a great deal of each player representative's time. We've had extra meetings because of the pension plan, and because of the minimum salary conditions, because of scheduling, three of the things that we have worked on, and it's taken a lot of the extra time that I have devoted actually to nothing, not playing ball. It doesn't take any time away from my ball playing. It just takes a few more of my leisure hours away, and I'm certainly happy to do it. I feel like that it's a great responsibility, and it's enjoyable to me to be able to be in on these things, because I'm definitely interested in baseball since it is my profession, and I want to try to improve in any way I can. I think it's easier for a pitcher to do it than it would be an infielder or an outfielder, someone who played every day, because we can program our time a little better and consequently have more time available for player representative matters.
You know, Steve, one of the most interesting things, really, as far as the player representative is concerned and the activity involved in this, is the places that you have to go to resolve your problems. Now, most of the problems seem to have been resolved with very little friction between the players and the management. Do you find that this is holding true, that there's a very fine relationship between the two?
I think our relationship's improving. I think it could be better, probably from both sides. I know sometimes maybe the management thinks we're unreasonable, and I know there are lots of times that we think they're unreasonable. I think it is improving. I think since we now have a Players Association with a full-time head and Mr. Marvin Miller, that things have gotten considerably better, and I think that it's going to be a lot better.
Well, we've been talking to Steve Hamilton. Nice to have you with us, Steve. And some of the aspects of baseball behind the scenes that occasionally people are not aware of. We'll be back right after this word. Hi, Jerry Coleman here to remind all of you fans out there about a real big plus when you drop by Yankee Stadium. And I'm talking about the new 1967 Yankee Yearbook. It's full of facts and information about all of the great Yankees, their biographies, their great days. And in the centerfold, they have four pages of beautiful color action shots and some great family scenes, too, in the back pages. So when you come to the stadium, this is something you ought to pick up, really, because it gives you the comprehensive and complete rundown on all of the Yankees. You can read about the Yankees in the Yankee Yearbook, and if you'd like to purchase them, you can do it right here at the stadium for 50 cents, or you can order by mail. Just send 65 cents to Yankee Yearbook, Bronx Central Post Office, Post Office Box 1967, Bronx, New York, and the zip code on that is 10451. Once again, to pick up your Yankee Yearbook, it's 65 cents if you order by mail, Bronx Central Post Office, Box 1967, Bronx, New York, and the zip code again, 10451. So that's it, or you can get it at the stadium for just 50 cents. Right now, stay tuned for the second game of today's doubleheader following station identification.
This is the talk that we had right after the announcement.
Whitey, first of all, when was the final decision determined?
Well, I think it was yesterday, Marv, when I talked to Mr. MacPhail and Mr. Burke. I had more or less made a decision last Sunday after I had left the game in Detroit. After pitching one inning, I had a plane ride back from Detroit by myself, and I gave it a lot of thought. Talked to my wife all week, talked to Dr. Gaynor last Monday, and we wrapped it all up together and just decided that this would be the best time to pack it in.
Last week on the post-game show, you had mentioned that, well, you'd try to throw before the start of the doubleheader today, but apparently you just decided that's it without even going out and taking the uniform and throwing the baseball.
Yes, I talked to Dr. Gaynor after that, and he says, well, it might feel good for 5 or 10 minutes, but it's just going to get irritated again and just kick up. And he says, we'd just be kidding ourselves if we thought that it would be healed permanently.
This is your toughest decision ever?
Oh, I think it's just, yes, it has to be the toughest decision I've ever made, but I knew it was going to come eventually, and in 1960, I had a lot of trouble with my shoulder, and I thought about it then, and I consider myself lucky to have been able to pitch another 6 or 7 years after that.
Whitey, as you look back, is there any one particular ball game, any one particular pitch that you remember above all?
Well, I think one pitch I remember, if you just want to go with one pitch, it was in 1950. 1958 or something, up in Boston, bases loaded, 3-0 on Ted Williams, and we're winning 3-1, and I threw him a fastball right down the middle, and he hit into a double play, and we won the game and the pennant, and for one pitch. And then for one game, I'd probably have to say the game that broke Babe Ruth's scoreless record in the World Series in 1961.
Now, the plans from here on in are for you to remain with the Yankees as kind of a super scout.
Well, I don't know what my title is yet, but Manager Houck is going to keep me busy. I'm the Yankee front office, so I'm sure I'll have enough to do, scout the National League and go around and check our minor league teams and sort of give an analysis of what I think of some of the pitches, and maybe I could help them in some way.
Whitey, thank you very much, and let me say we will miss you.
Thank you very much, Marv.
A great Whitey Ford, and today the playing career of the Yankees' all-time greatest pitcher came to an end here at the press conference at Yankee Stadium.